The Water Margin by Shi Naian. Translated by J. H. Jackson. Narrated by Jonathan Booth for Ukemi Audiobooks. Preface by Edwin H. Lowe. About the book, its translation, revision, and romanization. The Water Margin, Shui Hu Juan, is a classic Chinese novel dating from the beginning of the Ming Dynasty in 1368 CE. Notionally written by Shi Naian circa 1296 to 1372 CE, in the Chinese tradition of vernacular literature, it evolved under the editorship of many editors and commentators until it was published as a 120-chapter version in 1592 under the editorship of Li Ji. In 1641, Shui Hu Juan was published as a 70-chapter version under the extensive editorship and commentary of Jin Shengtang. Despite being banned by imperial edict at the end of the Ming Dynasty, and again during the Qing Dynasty, the novel became one of the most influential of the four great classic novels of vernacular Chinese literature. Shui Hu Juan was first translated into English by Pearl S. Buck in 1933, as All Men Are Brothers. Using Jin Shen Tang's 70-chapter version, Buck based the title of her work on the famous quote from Confucius, "Within the four seas, all men are brothers," which was quoted by several characters in the Shui Hu Juan, since she believed that this quotation captured the true spirit of the novel. Buck believed that the literal translation of Shui Hu Juan, the Chronicles of the Water Margin, to be meaningless for the English language reader, acquainting themselves with the Shui Hu story for the first time. This edition of Shui Hu Juan was originally published by the Commercial Press Limited in Shanghai and translated by J. H. Jackson in 1937. It was this translation that gave the English language the title The Water Margin. J. H. Jackson's translation of the 70-chapter version improved several shortcomings of Pearl Buck's initial translation. Unlike Buck's version, which impeded the narrative by her artificial style and pedestrian progress, Jackson managed to maintain the rapid pace of action in the story. However, there are shortcomings in Jackson's translation, which have been attributed to his desire for literal exactness and his prosaic style, which often compounded descriptive lines and passages into terse and abrupt statements. It's not known how long Jackson took to translate his version of Water Margin, nor under what conditions did he work. Jackson's original translation shows some degree of inconsistency in the translation of recurring titles or terms. It is possible that this is indicative of a hurried translation and publication process, though it is rather more likely, given the enormity of the task, that the process of translation was slow, perhaps taking years. It's rather more plausible that the task was secondary to whatever Jackson's vocation was. Water Margin appears to be J.H. Jackson's only known work, taking a long period of time and set aside from time to time, which may explain any minor inconsistencies. History may have also caught up with J.H. Jackson, since by 1937, China had already been racked by 10 years of civil war between the Chinese Communist Party and the Kuomintang government. Adding to the social chaos, after many years of Japanese incursions and skirmishes, tensions were beginning to reach boiling point. In 1932, the building of Jackson's publisher, the Commercial Press Limited in Shanghai, was bombed during a Japanese air raid on the city. In July 1937, the Sino-Japanese War, i.e. China's Second World War, broke out in earnest with a full-scale Japanese invasion. Little is known about J.H. Jackson today, with which might otherwise provide an insight into his translation of Water Margin and his treatment of the contents. Jackson's use of the English language does not present any particular flavour of idiom to suggest his nationality, though I do believe that he was American. Water Margin does use American spelling of the text, though this may simply be indicative of the origins of the Commercial Press Limited as the American Presbyterian Mission Press. And in one instance, Jackson uses the phrase, "Go tell that to the Marines." This phrase, while British in origin, is mostly associated with an American usage, particularly after the 1927 film set in China, Tell It to the Marines. It is possible that Jackson, like so many translators of the period, such as Pearl Buck, was himself a missionary or of a missionary family. There are perhaps some clues in Jackson's translation of distinctly Christian terms such as hell, Satan, God, devil, and the like. For distinctively Chinese concepts, characters, and deities from mythology and folk religion, or from Buddhism and Taoism. However, in the context of catering for the level of sinological knowledge of the average 1930s reader, this in itself is again not particularly indicative of any philosophical or religious origin. Similarly, Jackson's translation also uses what we may now consider to be degrading English language terminology of the early 20th century, such as the use of the word coolie for labourer, as well as more archaic sinological terms such as yeoman runner for court aid. Additionally, Jackson uses Anglophone terms and titles such as Mr. Wu and Mrs. Wang throughout the text, which tends to sound awkward in the setting of Song Dynasty China. Similarly, it is absolutely perplexing why, alone of all characters, Jackson translated the name of the infamous Shimen Qing into the literal translation of Mr. Westgate. Furthermore, there are some confusing inconsistencies in Jackson's translation that have more to do with sinological nuances than Jackson's ability as a translator. Primarily, these can be found in the interchangeable terms of soldier and policeman, as well as the blurred distinctions of titles and ranks of inspector, lieutenant, officials, judge, magistrate, and the like. This problem arises in the fact that until the 20th century, there was no independent police force from the army or militia. Likewise, in pre-modern China, officials at all levels of the imperial civil service held dual responsibilities of judicial and civil administration, and these distinctions can become blurred in the translation. Jackson's own level of sinological knowledge is therefore difficult to determine, given some of these anglicisations, simplifications, perplexing errors, and the need to cater for the average reader. However, given that he completed the mammoth task of translating the difficult text of the Water Margin in an admirably readable style, we can assume that Jackson's sinological knowledge, like his ability with the Chinese language, was in fact quite considerable. Contrastingly, and with a precision that may actually have been pedantry, Jackson translated such obscuranta as of the names of Chinese star constellations into their English language equivalents, as well as expressing the watches of the night, the measure of time, in precise terms of 12-hour AM-PM time. Jackson not only translated the original Chinese measures of weights and distances as jin, liang, and li, into the English measures of taels, ounces, and catties, pounds, and miles as used in the Far Eastern and China trade, but also precisely converted their numerical values. Additionally, Jackson translated the poetic verse studied throughout Jin Sheng Tang's version of Shui Hu Juan into English rhyme, and for the most part, managed to convey their meanings. In common with Buck's translation, Jackson's translation is somewhat sanitized compared to the Chinese text. Jackson originally omitted the vulgarity and the profanity of some of Water Margin's most beloved characters, such as Lu Da and Li Kui, and other minor characters of the common social classes, which gave the original Chinese text its vigor and verve. In doing so, Jackson removed the literary vehicle which allowed the reader to contrast the sober propriety of the well-educated scholars, which Jackson naturally conveyed very well, with the vulgarity and profanity of the common soldiery and citizenry. At best, and wherever possible, Jackson, like Buck, provided literal translations of some of the more vulgar profanities or appellations, which conveniently and ironically masked their true vulgarity. Likewise, in keeping with the Edwardian sensibilities of the pre-war world, Jackson omitted the more ribald descriptions of sexual seduction and intrigue, the vivid descriptions of death by arsenic poisoning, the blow-by-blow descriptions of the blood-splattering disembowelment, dismemberment, and mutilation of murder victims, and the precise description of what Westerners considered the most barbarous of Chinese judicial punishments, the Ling Qi, the public death by slow slicing, or death by a thousand cuts. In this edition of J.H. Jackson's The Water Margin, many of these shortcomings have been addressed. Retaining Jackson's translation, and therefore Jackson's original narrative and voice as much as possible, this edition of Jackson's Water Margin has been restored to a degree of its original grit and flavour, as Shi Naian, Qin Sheng Tang, and other editors had intended in their telling of Shui Hu Juan. I have translated and reinserted the sanitised descriptions of sexual seduction, the explicit descriptions of brutality and barbarity, and the profane voices of the thieving, scheming, drinking, fighting, pimping lower classes of Song Dynasty China. Similarly, the Chinese deities, bodhisattvas, gods and demons, have reclaimed their true names, as has the lecherous, oversexed and ill-fated Shi Men Qing. The more nuanced and archaic idioms such as go tell it to the Marines, coolie, Mr., Mrs., Miss, and Yamen runners have been either neutralized or updated for the sinologically aware 21st century reader. Similarly, I have retained the still familiar old trade term of tail in preference of ounce, but replaced the now forgotten catty with the Chinese word for the pound, qin. Conversely, I have replaced the English mile with the now more familiar Chinese word li. Of the system of romanization of Chinese names and places, Jackson used the then-standard Wade-Giles system. In this edition, I have updated these proper nouns using the pinyin system, which is the official standard of romanization of the People's Republic of China. I have also used a little more care and consistency, since I am neither caught up in a civil war nor a foreign invasion, in order to distinguish soldiers from policemen, and county magistrates, city prefects, provincial governors from one another. Historical titles, correct in Jackson's literal translation, but incorrect in their definitions, have been corrected, so that Jackson's Imperial Tutor Tsai is more accurately Prime Minister Tsai. Likewise, incorrect translations of titles such as Minister of War have also been corrected to Marshal of the Imperial Guard. Jackson also made explanations and comments in the form of in-text notes in parentheses. Some of these were quite awkward and at times superfluous. I have tidied these up by either deleting them or adding further comments of my own wherever they were required as footnotes. I have done this in order to distinguish my comments from Jackson's. Any errors and omissions in this process of editing are, of course, mine alone. Readers of this edition must understand that this is in no way a new translation or a reinterpretation of the Shui Hu story. In my more fanciful and vainglorious moments, I see myself merely continuing the Chinese literary tradition of editorship and revision of Shui Hu Juan, rather than changing or rewriting Jackson's The Water Margin. From Shi Naian, Shui Hu Juan was passed through the editorship of many, until the 120-chapter version reached Jin Sheng Tang. From Jin Sheng Tang, a 70-chapter version passed into the English language through Pearl S. Buck, J.H. Jackson, and now from Jackson to me. In 1981, Sidney Shapiro, the Brooklyn-born U.S. soldier, lawyer, and naturalized Chinese citizen, translated the 100-chapter version of Shui Hu Juan as Outlaws of the Marsh. This edition is excellent in its English translation, though given the mores of China and the United States in 1981, it does not do the more colourful gutter language its full justice. From 1994 to 2002, a new translation by John and Alex Dent Young of the 120-chapter version was published as The Marshes of Mount Liang. This too is an excellent translation, with a restoration of the more vivid language of the Chinese text. One possible minor problem, however, is the use of British idiom, such as, "Why are you staring at me, mate?" The other replied, "I ain't your mate." While it may be quite natural to the Dent Youngs and I to refer to another person as mate in an ambivalent manner, and while it may be delightfully refreshing reading to those of us who use the British or Commonwealth idiom, it may be difficult for others not so accustomed. Therefore, despite the excellent contemporary translations of the editions of Sidney Shapiro and of John and Alex Dent Young, this version, translated in 1937 by Jackson and now rejuvenated in 2009, remains the definitive English edition of the 70-chapter version. In the following introduction to this edition, I have not attempted any scholarly analysis or criticism of either Shōi Huzhuan as a work of literature or of J.H. Jackson's translation of The Water Margin. This has been comprehensively done by many other scholars over the last 650 years and has been done much more skillfully than I am able to do. I have provided some very basic coverage of literary criticism of Shōi Huzhuan, and those readers wishing to further pursue this fascinating field may consider beginning with the references that I have cited. I have also introduced Jin Sheng Tang and his 70-chapter version of the Shōi Huzhuan, as well as the themes and concepts surrounding the story of Shōi Huzhuan and their importance in the Chinese socio-political order. I also discussed the nexus of the concept of bandit rebellions with the Chinese socio-political order and how these are central to the Shōi Huzhuan story and the influence of Shōi Huzhuan in Chinese history. Finally, in the completion of this work, I must, as always, thank Emma Runcie for her unconditional love and support. At Macquarie University, I must thank Professor Daniel Kane for the loan of his copy of the Shōi Hu Yuqi Sidian, which was of invaluable assistance. Just as importantly, I must also thank Professor Kane and Ms. Jennifer Cheng for guiding my Cantonese tongue through the finer points of the vivid gutter language of North China and the Central Plains. Edwin H. Lowe, Macquarie University, Sydney, 2009. Foreword by Shi Naian. A man should not marry after 30 years of age, should not enter the government service after the age of 40, should not have any more children after the age of 50, and should not travel after the age of 60. This is because the proper time for those things has passed. At sunrise, the country is bright and fresh, and you dress, wash, and eat your breakfast. But before long, it is noon. Then you realize how quickly time passes. I am always surprised when people talk about other people's ages, because what is a lifetime but a small part of a much greater period? Why talk about insects when the whole world is before you? How can you count time by years? All that is clear is that time passes, and all the time there is a continual change going on. Some change has taken place ever since I began to write this. This continual change and decay fills me with sadness. What excites pleasure in me is the meeting and conversing with old friends. But it is very galling when my friends do not visit me, because there is a biting wind, or the roads are muddy through the rain, or perhaps because they are sick. Then I feel isolated. Although I myself do not drink, yet I provide spirits for my friends, as my family has a few fields in which we grow millet. In front of my house runs a great river, and there I can sit with my friends in the shadow of the lovely trees. I have four old women to do the cooking and household affairs, and also 10 small boys who act as messengers. And when they have nothing to do, they fill up their spare time in making brooms and mats. If all my friends came, there would be 16. But because of the weather, there are seldom more than 6 or 7 here. When they come, they drink and chat, just as they please. But our pleasure is in the conversation, and not in the liquor. We do not discuss politics because we are so isolated here that our news is simply composed of rumours, and it would only be a waste of time to talk with untrustworthy information. We also never talk about other people's faults, because in this world nobody is wrong, and we should beware of backbiting. We do not wish to injure anyone, and therefore our conversation is of no consequence to anyone. We discuss human nature, about which people know so little because they are too busy to study it. My friends are all broad-minded and well-educated, but we do not keep a record of our conversations. The reason for this is, one, we are too lazy and do not aspire to fame. Two, to talk gives us pleasure, but to write would give trouble. Three, none of us would be able to read it again after our deaths, so why worry? Four, if we wrote something this year, we should probably find it all wrong the next year. I have written these 70 chapters of the Shuihu just for my own pleasure after my friends had left, or when they had not turned up owing to the weather. I have had no preconceived plan, but have jotted these items down just as they occurred to me, sometimes when sitting outside near the bamboo fence, or at early dawn when lying on my couch in pensive mood. But someone may ask, as you did not write down your friends' conversations, why have you written this book? To which I reply, one, because it is just a hodgepodge and cannot make me famous or even discredit me. Two, I have only done this to fill up my spare time and give pleasure to myself. Three, I have written it so that the uneducated can read it as well as the educated. Four, I have used this style of composition because it is such a trifle. Alas, life is so short that I shall not even know what the reader thinks about it, but still I shall be satisfied if a few of my friends will read it and be interested. Also, I do not know what I may think of it in my future life after death, because then I may not be able to even read it. So why think anything further about it?
Shi Naian. The Water Margin by Shi Naian. Prologue. Heavenly Teacher Zhang prays for cessation of a pestilence. Marshal Hong makes a blunder in releasing demons. Amid chaos of dynasties five, peaceful days at last revive, mountains and rivers are of yore, benevolence of 100 years and more. Orioles sang in forest trees, entrancing music filled the air, the people dressed in gorgeous silks. Contentment reigned everywhere. This poetry was written in the reign of Emperor Shenzong of the Song Dynasty by a famous scholar named Shao Yaofu. At the close of the Tang Dynasty and during the succeeding five dynasties, there was continual civil warfare. In the morning, one general would be supreme, but by evening, another general would be in power. Generals Zhu Quanzhong, Li Kunzhu, Shi Jingtang, Liu Zhuan, and Guo Wai established respectively the five dynasties of the later Liang, later Tang, later Jin, later Han, and later Zhou, 907 to 960 CE. There were 15 emperors within 50 years. These frequent changes followed one after another, until Zhao Kuangyin founded the Song Dynasty and ascended the throne as Emperor Taizu. When this great man was born, the sky was all red, and in the bedroom there was a fragrant smell. This was because the god of thunder descended among the mortals. Taizu was a brave hero and very intelligent. No emperor from ancient times to the present can be compared to him. He was a well-made man and conquered 400 prefectures and regions. He swept the floor of the whole empire and left it clean. He established his capital at Bianliang in modern Kaifeng and laid the foundations for the succeeding 18 emperors of the Song Dynasty, which lasted for 300 years. Because of this illustrious feat of arms, the scholar states that the clouds were dispersed and heaven seen again. At that time, there was a very virtuous and learned man named Chen Chuan living on the western sacred mountain, Mount Hua, and he could foreknow the weather. One day, as he was riding on his donkey down the mountain, he heard a rumour that Chai Shizong had withdrawn in favour of Marshal Zhao Kuangyin, who had ascended the throne. When he heard this, he laughed so much that he rolled off the donkey. When his informer asked for an explanation, he replied, "The empire will now be settled, and heaven, earth, and mankind will all be in harmony." The Emperor Taizu ascended the throne in 960 CE, and for the following 17 years there was general peace. He was succeeded by his descendant, Emperors Taizong, Zhenzong, and Renzong. Now Renzong was the incarnation of the barefoot immortal, and when he was born, he cried continuously, day and night. His father, Emperor Zhenzong, issued an edict offering a reward to anyone who could cure the crying infant. When this became known in heaven, the great white gold star was sent down to earth and metamorphosed into an old man. He tore down the imperial edict and said that he could effect a cure. An official took him to the court, where the emperor gave him permission to see the sick baby. Upon entering the palace, he picked up the royal infant in his arms and whispered 8 words into his ear. Immediately the royal infant stopped crying, and the old man vanished in a gust of wind. The words he whispered were, "For civil affairs there is a civil star, for military affairs a military star." As a matter of fact, the Jade Emperor of Heaven, the great Taoist god, had already sent 2 stars to assist this newborn infant in those affairs when he became emperor. The civil star was incarnated in Bao Zheng, who later became a scholar of the Long Tu Academy and also prefect of Kaifeng. The military star was incarnated in Di Qing, who became commander-in-chief of the expedition to the Western Xia Kingdom in modern Gansu. These 2 worthy ministers assisted the Emperor Renzong for 42 years. During the first 27 years, the crops were abundant, and there was general peace and prosperity. Robbery was rare, and the people could always leave their doors open, even at night. In fact, the people enjoyed abundant happiness in those years. But who could know that great happiness would be culminated in sorrow? In the 28th year, a grave pestilence afflicted the empire, and a flood of petitions inundated the capital like a heavy snowstorm. In the eastern capital, half of the people died. The Grand Secretary, Bao Zheng, offered a special medicine free, but with no effect. The pestilence spread and increased its virility. The officials discussed the situation in the council chamber, and when the emperor gave audience, they all entered the Grand Audience Hall, where they all kowtowed together. The appointed minister asked what business there was to bring before the emperor, and the prime minister Zhao Zhe and the official Wen Yanbo stepped forward. The former spoke. "Just now there is a serious pestilence in this capital, and a great many people have died. I request that in your benevolence an edict be issued, pardoning all criminals, reducing all sentences for future crimes, and lessening all taxes. We also beg your majesty to offer prayers to heaven to save the lives of your people." The emperor at once agreed to this, and added to the edict that in all temples there should be special prayers to heaven to stop this great calamity. Although this was done, the pestilence still increased its ravages. When the emperor was informed of this, he summoned all the ministers to discuss the matter. And during the meeting of the Grand Council, Fan Zhongyan spoke. "This great calamity is inflicting the people who are on the verge of despair. I suggest that we send for the Taoist, heavenly teacher Zhang, at Mount Longhu, Jiangxi province, to offer special prayers here for the cessation of the pestilence." The Emperor Renzong agreed and ordered a Hanlin scholar to write the edict. He signed it with the vermilion brush and handed it to Marshal Hong Xin to deliver it as the imperial envoy. Hong Xin fastened the edict on his back, held the imperial incense in his hand, took about 10 assistants, travelled by relays of horses, and soon reached Guixi County in Jiangxi province. He was met and welcomed outside the various towns he passed through by the local officials. A messenger had been sent in advance to advise Heavenly Teacher Zhang of the approaching envoy. Upon reaching Mount Longhu, he was received by a big crowd of Taoist priests, with much beating of drums and gongs, much burning of incense, fluttering banners, and music. The temple abbot conducted the envoy into the Hall of 3 Purities, where the imperial edict was respectfully received. When the envoy, Marshal Hong Xin, asked for Heavenly Teacher Zhang, the superintendent replied, "The Heavenly Teacher is known as Shu Jing, who has a pure and lofty nature. He is averse to soliciting favour and has retired to a straw hut on the summit of the mountain, where he cultivates his spirit." "Then how can I see him about this important matter?" asked Hong Xin. "We can leave the imperial edict here unopened while we discuss that matter in another room.
replied the superintendent. This was done, and the envoy took the seat of honour while attendants brought in tea and vegetarian food for all. After the meal, the superintendent explained that the heavenly teacher had acquired the Tao, and since he travelled on clouds, they never knew where he might be. They very seldom saw him at the temple, so they thought it hardly worthwhile to advise him of the approach of the imperial envoy. Hong Xin explained what the edict was about, and asked how he could meet the heavenly teacher. The superintendent replied, "As the emperor wishes to save the people, you must carry out his orders. You must therefore purify yourself by fasting, dress in plain, rough clothes, then go by yourself with the imperial edict on your back, step by step up the mountain, and then you may have the chance of seeing the heavenly teacher. But if your heart is not truly sincere, that may spoil your chance of meeting him." "Since I left the capital," said Hong Xin, "I have been a strict vegetarian, so how could my intentions be other than absolutely sincere? Such being the case, I will follow your advice and go up the mountain tomorrow." The following morning, about 4 a.m., the priests prepared the fragrant water and invited the envoy to bathe. After bathing, he put on new rough clothes and straw sandals, wrapped the imperial edict in yellow silk and fastened it on his back, took a silver bowl with burning incense in his hands. He took leave of the priests and set off, saying prayers as he walked. After some time, the path became steeper, and he had to take hold of bushes and trees to pull himself up. He had traversed several summits and began to feel extremely fatigued. It was now very hard walking, and he became hesitant as to whether to go forward or not. He thought of the pleasant, easy times he used to have in the capital, with rich, varied food and comfortable beds. There he never wore rough clothes and straw sandals and was never tired like this. Why did they send him to experience such bitterness of soul? How could he find the heavenly teacher? He struggled on for about 50 paces more, but was now panting for breath. A strong gust of wind blew down the ravine and roared through the pines. Just then he saw a tiger rush out from the trees and was so afraid and startled that he fell down. The tiger examined the envoy, walked round him, but after roaring, returned to the forest. Hong Xin lay there, his teeth grinding and his heart beating like a chain of buckets raising water from a well. His sensation became numb, and he seemed paralyzed. His legs could not move, and seemed like a defeated cock after a fight. He began to whine about his fate. But after a short time, his spirits gradually revived, and he continued his walk. He was, however, still short of breath, and began again to complain of the hardness of the way. He muttered, "The emperor gave me a very hard task." But before he had finished this, a very noxious wind burst forth. He stared round, and saw an enormous speckled snake rattling among some bamboos. He was startled, and throwing away his bowl, fell down near a large stone, exclaiming, "I shall certainly die this time." The snake glided towards him and coiled up at his side. It showed a yellow light in its eyes, opened wide its mouth, and blew a poisonous vapour in his face. This so frightened him that he fainted, but the snake soon left him. When he regained consciousness, he saw that his body was as chilly as having been thrown into an icy river. He soliloquized, "I was almost frightened to death. I never suspected that priest of deceiving me. What a shock I had. If I don't find the heavenly teacher, I shall have something to say to that priest when I get back." He, however, picked up his incense bowl, put on his headdress, straightened his garments, and prepared to try again. He had taken only a few steps when he heard the sound of a flute, which was being played somewhere among the trees. Looking round, he saw an acolyte riding on a yellow ox, playing a flute with a smiling countenance. Hong spoke to him. "Where do you come from? Do you recognize me?" The boy did not reply, but continued playing the flute. Hong asked the same questions several times, and at last the boy laughed and, pointing his flute at him, replied, "Have you come here to see the heavenly teacher? As you are only a cowherd, how is it that you know my affairs?" Early this morning, I waited upon the heavenly teacher, and he told me that you'd been commissioned by the emperor to bring an edict here inviting him to go to the capital to offer prayers to heaven to stop the pestilence. He said that he was going to mount his stork and fly off to the capital at once. So I think he may have gone and may not be at the temple. You need not go up the mountain, as there are many poisonous snakes and fierce beasts on this mountain which might endanger your life.
You cannot lie to me, said Hong.
But the acolyte did not reply to this, and went on his way, playing his flute. The envoy thought, how can the boy know as much as he says? It may be that the heavenly teacher has told him to say this so as to test my perseverance. But as I have already met so many frightful things, perhaps it would be better if I now get back. So he retraced his steps. Upon reaching the temple at the foot of the mountain, he was asked by the priests whether he had seen the heavenly teacher. He told them what frightful experiences he had had, and said he suspected them of merely trifling with an imperial envoy.
"How dare we poor Taoists treat you disrespectfully?" replied the abbot. "These trials might have been arranged by the heavenly teacher to test your perseverance. The snakes and tigers on this mountain do not injure people."
As I was going to struggle up the mountain, I saw a cowherd coming out of a pine forest on a yellow cow, playing a flute, who told me that the heavenly teacher had flown away on a crane this morning to the eastern capital, and so I returned.
What a pity that you missed such a fine opportunity. That cowherd was the heavenly teacher himself.
In that case, why did he appear in such a strange way?
Because he's not an ordinary man. He is only young, but his supernatural power is unbounded. He's not a common person. His power is omnipotent. The people all praise him as the master of the Tao.
I am so ignorant that I have failed to deliver the edict.
Never mind. As the heavenly teacher meant to go, I think the prayers may have been over, and the pestilence already vanished when you get back to the eastern capital.
The imperial edict was replaced in the cover and put in the Hall of Three Purities. A feast was then prepared for the envoy. After breakfast the following morning, the abbot suggested that they should stroll round the monastery for a sightseeing. They did so, and spent some time going round all the temple buildings. One of these attracted Marshal Hong Xin's attention. It was surrounded by a red mud wall. The entrance had a large red door with two leaves that were fastened by a very big lock. There were about 10 strips of paper sealing the door, and these were all stamped with red seals. Above the door was a board with four gilt characters, "The Subdued Demon's Hall." The envoy asked what the hall was used for, and was informed that a previous heavenly teacher had subdued many demons and imprisoned them there. But why are there so many seals on the door? During the Tang Dynasty, the heavenly teacher Dong Xuan subdued the king of the demons and locked him up inside this hall. The succeeding generations have each added another seal, so that it may never be opened. If those devils ever got out, there would be a great calamity. Now about 9 generations have passed, and no one ever attempted to tamper with this arrangement. Molten copper has been poured into the lock, so that it is impossible to unlock the door. I have lived here for 30 years, and this is all that I have heard of, but nobody knows what is inside. Marshal Hong Xin felt very curious at this, and had a desire to investigate. So he said to the superintendent, "Please open the door, and I will see what this king of the demons is like."
"We dare not do that. Our former masters enjoined us not to open it, and we cannot presume to disobey the order."
The imperial envoy laughed and said, "Nonsense! You only falsely declare there is something strange in order to deceive the innocent people. You purposely arrange such places and tell people that demons are locked up inside so as to show off your spiritual powers. I have read hundreds of volumes of books, and yet have never read of the king of the demons being imprisoned here. There is no way by which man can know about the supernatural. I do not believe that the king of the demons is inside here. Quickly open the door, and I want to see what this demon is." The abbot still declined to do this, as he was afraid that somebody would be injured. Marshal Hong became angry, and pointing at the Taoist, said,
"As you will not open the door, I shall first report that you refuse to obey the imperial orders and not allow me to see the heavenly teacher. Also, I will say that you are falsely declaring that the king of the demons is imprisoned here. in order to deceive decent people. Your license will be cancelled, and you will all be banished to some distant places."
The priests were all afraid of his great influence. Therefore they summoned servants to tear off the seals and break the big lock. This was done, and when the door was opened, they all went inside, but could not see anything because it was pitch dark there. So Marshal Hong ordered the servants to light about 10 torches, and with these he made a close examination. There was not a single thing except a stone tablet in the centre of the hall. It was about 6 feet in height, and was resting on a stone tortoise which was almost half in the soil. On the tablet were characters of the very ancient style, and they could not make out any of them. But upon examining the other side of the tablet, they found 4 characters which read, "Open when Hong comes." The imperial envoy, Marshal Hong Xin, was much pleased at this, and turning to the Taoist said, "You tried to obstruct me, but many hundreds of years ago they wrote my name here and predicted that I would come here and open the door. The fiends, I see, are imprisoned under this tortoise. Dig out the stone tortoise for me." The Taoists were terrified at the order and said that it was not safe to do such a thing. Marshal Hong was angry at this continuous obstruction and abused them as ignorant. He insisted upon the excavation being begun immediately. As on the stone tablet it was stated that he would open the place, so although the Taoists still objected, they at last gave way and told the workmen to dig. The men removed the soil and the tortoise. After digging about 3 feet down, they unearthed a square slab of stone. Marshal Hong told them to lift it out, and in spite of objections from the Taoists, the stone was raised and carried out of the hole. It was evident that the slab was the cover of a very deep well. Now that the cover was removed, a loud, strange noise was heard far down in the cavity, and instantly a black cloud shot out from below, breaking a corner of the roof of the hall, and escaped through the aperture. The cloud ascended very high in the sky, and then burst forth into more than 100 rays of light, and disappeared in all directions. All the spectators were astounded, and rushed away from the hall. Even Marshal Hong was thunderstruck, and his countenance changed to a pale yellow colour. He went out to the veranda, where he met the abbot, who lamented the result. Upon his asking what the demon was which had escaped, the superintendent replied, "You do not understand. The fact is that our former master, Dong Zan, imprisoned here the 36 heavenly spirits, and 72 baneful stars, which make a total of 108 fiends. The names of these fiends are inscribed on the stone in ancient writing. As they have now all been released, they will bring calamity to the people. What are you going to do in the matter?" Upon hearing this, Marshal Hong was covered with cold perspiration and trembled with fear. Without saying a word, he went to pack his baggage, and calling together his retinue, he quickly departed down the mountain on his way back to the capital. On the way, Marshal Hong told his suite that they must not mention to anybody what had happened, as he was afraid that if the emperor heard of it, he would be punished. They travelled both night and day, and soon reached the capital, Bianliang, in modern Kaifeng. There he found that the Taoist heavenly teacher had arrived and had held 7 days' service against the pestilence and had written magical spells for the sick people. And as the pestilence had abated, the heavenly teacher had flown back on his stalk to the mountain. The following morning, Marshal Hong attended the early audience and addressed the emperor. "The heavenly teacher travelled by crane, and as I could only travel by horse relays, he had been here and returned before I could arrive." The emperor did not reply, but rewarded him for his work. After this, the emperor reigned for 42 years, and upon his death, as he had no children, the son of an illustrious prince succeeded to the throne with the title Yinzong. This emperor reigned for 4 years and was followed by his son, who reigned as Emperor Shenzong for 18 years. Then, after this, Emperor Jezong reigned, and during his reign there was peace in the empire. But if there had been nothing but peace, what in this book are we going to relate? My good reader, rest assured that this is merely a prelude. And in the following chapters, we have Chapter 1. Drill Instructor Wang
goes stealthily to Yanan Prefecture. Shi Jin defends his village. During the reign of the Emperor Zhezong of the Song Dynasty, there lived at the eastern capital, Bianliang, in Kaifeng Prefecture, a loose profligate named Gao. He could handle well either spear or cudgel, and was an extremely good player at football. He was the second son of a Gao family, but instead of calling him Gao the Second, people gave him the nickname of Gao Chu, meaning Gao the Ball. Later on, however, he adopted another character, also pronounced Chu. He could play well on wood or string instruments, but was no good at poetry or literature. If there was a discussion of benevolence, justice, propriety, wisdom, or virtue, he was unable to take part. He wasted his time in the company of the son of a wealthy man, and every day these two spent their time in pleasure resorts. His conduct became so bad that at last the wealthy man lodged a complaint before the prefect, who had him arrested, punished with 20 blows of the bamboo, and then banished from the capital. Gao Chu went to Waishi in Linhuai Prefecture, where he found refuge in a gambling den, which afforded shelter to all the lazy rascals from all places. 3 years after this, however, the emperor granted an amnesty so as to show his benevolence. Upon hearing of this, Gao Chu decided to return to the capital and got an introduction to a man named Dong Jiangshi, who kept a drugstore at the Jinliang Bridge. Upon reading the letter, this man remembered the bad reputation of Gao Chu and was afraid that if he lived at his house, he might have an evil influence on his children. So after about 10 days, Dong spoke to Gao Chu. "Here we can offer you little help. I will, however, recommend you to a certain Su the Younger, a scholar who may assist you in cutting a fine career. What do you think of that?" Gao Chu was much pleased at this and thanked Dong Jiangshi. Dong wrote a note and sent this with Gao Chu to the residence of the high official. The doorkeeper announced the arrival, and the scholar Su came out to see Gao Chu. He also remembered that Gao Chu was a profligate and decided to get rid of him by recommending him to the emperor's son-in-law, the prince consort Wang Jingqing, as a steward. The following day, Su sent Gao Chu with a servant to prince consort Wang Jingqing. This prince Wang was the husband of the younger sister of the emperor Zhezong and son-in-law of the emperor Shenzong. He took pleasure in meeting flamboyant, stylish men, and when he received the introduction, he was glad, and he made Gao Chu his personal attendant. An ancient saying is, "Remoteness begets neglect, nearness brings about intimacy." It happened that on his birthday, Prince Wang suddenly gave orders to prepare a feast, and especially invited his maternal uncle, Prince Duan, who was the 11th son of the late Emperor Shenzong, and the younger brother of the Emperor Zhezong. He controlled the affairs of the emperor's eastern palaces, where he was known as the Ninth Prince. He was intelligent and handsome, but his taste was not so, he preferring profligacy. However, he was a good performer on the lute, he could play chess, paint pictures, and was an excellent footballer. On the day mentioned, Prince Duan took the seat of honour at the feast prepared. When the wine was brought in, they drank several cups. And after the second course, Prince Duan took leave for the toilet. He then retired to the library for a rest, and there he happened to see on the reading table a pair of lions made of white jade, used as paperweights. They were of elegant workmanship, and he admired them very much. Prince Wang saw that Prince Duan was fond of them, so he said, "There is also a jade brush rack with a dragon design made by the same hand, but it is not here now. I will get it tomorrow and send both of them to you." Prince Duan was much pleased and said, "I am obliged for your generosity. I think the brush rack must be very fine." The two men then returned to the banquet and feasted until the evening. When they were very intoxicated, they separated, and Prince Duan returned to the palace. The following day, Prince Wang packed the two jade lion paperweights and the jade brush rack in a golden box, wrote a letter, and sent Gao Chu off with them. Upon reaching Prince Duan's palace, the doorkeeper reported his arrival to the courtyard attendant, who inquired his business
and then said, "My master is playing football with the eunuchs in the courtyard. You may go in by yourself."
The courtyard attendant accompanied him to the gate, and there Gao Chu saw Prince Duan wearing as a cap a soft gauze towel of the Tang dynasty style, and arrayed in a purple gown embroidered with a dragon and a waist belt with two tassels. The gown was folded up and tucked in the belt. His boots were inlaid with golden thread in the design of a phoenix. There were three or five eunuchs playing football with him. Gao Chu dared not to intrude, so he took up his position behind the servants. Now good luck had come to Gao Chu. The ball rebounded from the ground, and Prince Duan failed to kick it. It bounced into the crowd of spectators and landed at the side of Gao Chu. He saw the ball and instantly had courage. He used the Mandarin duck twist, one leg behind the other, and kicked the ball back to Prince Duan. Prince Duan saw this, and being pleased with the exhibition, asked who he was. Gao Chu knelt down and said, "I am a confidential servant of Prince Consort Wang, and by his orders, I have brought two jade curios to present to your highness." So saying, he offered the letter with both hands. Prince Duan, hearing this, laughed and said that Prince Wang was very obliging. He opened the box and, after examining the curios, handed them to an attendant. He then asked Gao Chu, "Can you play football? Who are you?" Gao Chu, clasping his hands and kneeling down, said, "I am called Gao Chu. I was punishable for kicking that football." Prince Duan said, "Good, come into the playground and again try." Gao Chu saluted with folded arms and said, "What kind of man am I to dare play with your highness?" Prince Duan replied, "This is the Society of Gathering of Clouds, also known as the World's Horizon, meaning there is plenty of room for you. It does not matter if you play." Gao Chu again saluted, saying, "I cannot do it." He begged leave to depart time and again, but as Prince Duan insisted upon his playing, Gao Chu had no escape. So he kowtowed and confessed his inability. He then untied the garters round his knees and moved towards the centre of the ground. Gao Chu kicked a few times, and Prince Duan applauded. Gao Chu had to use all his skill to please the prince. He played the ball as though it stuck to his body like glue or paste. He never missed it. Prince Duan was highly amused and was unwilling to let Gao Chu return, so he kept him there for the night. Next day, Prince Duan ordered a banquet and sent a special invitation to Prince Consort Wang. The latter had become anxious at the absence of Gao Chu, but upon receipt of this invitation, he mounted a horse and went to Prince Duan's palace. Upon entering the banquet hall, Duan expressed his gratitude for the curios and then said, "This man Gao Chu kicks equally well with both feet. I should like to have him for my personal attendant. What do you say?" Prince Wang answered, "If you have any use for him, you may keep him." Prince Duan was pleased, and offering a cup of wine, thanked him. The two men chatted until evening. From that time, Prince Duan had Gao Chu as a special servant, and the latter did his work well. Every day he accompanied Prince Duan and was always close at his hand. In less than 2 months, the Emperor Zhezong died without an heir. A large number of civil and military officials petitioned Prince Duan to become emperor. He ascended the throne with the reign title of Haizong, and known with the Taoist titles of High Priest of Jade Purity and the Emperor of Subtle Truth. Upon ascending the throne, he did nothing remarkable. One day he said to Gao Chu, "I want to make you an official, but I cannot promote you unless you have shown your merit. Now I will first tell the Grand Council to record your name as an imperial attendant." Within 6 months, Gao Chu was raised to Marshal of the Imperial Guard. Before proceeding to his new post, he selected a fortunate hour and a lucky day to begin his duties. All the lower officers of various military ranks, both cavalry and infantry, visited him to pay their respects, present their credentials with details of their records. Gao Chu, the Marshal of the Imperial Guard, examined these reports one by one and noticed one was missing, that is, of Wang Jin, the drill instructor of the Imperial Guard. About 2 weeks before, Wang Jin had been sick and had not been able to attend business at his yamen, the office of a government official.
Gao Chu was very angry at this and shouted, "What nonsense! His credentials are here, but he himself has not come. This is disobedience. Yet he pretends to be sick at home. Men, have him brought here at once."
He forthwith sent men to arrest Wang Jin. Now this Wang Jin had no wife and lived with his mother, who was over 60 years of age. The sergeant spoke to Wang Jin.
"Marshal Gao Chu of the Imperial Guard has assumed his post, but has not yet seen you. The adjutant reported that you were sick at home, but Marshal Gao Chu did not believe this and has sent me to arrest you. You had better go and see him. If you do not go, I shall be implicated."
Wang Jin, hearing this, saw no alternative but to go, in spite of his sickness. Upon entering the door of the headquarters, he saw the marshal at the other end of the hall and kowtowed four times. Then, bowing, he called Nuo, a sound to attract attention almost equivalent to saying, "Waiting your order." Then, lifting his head, he stood at one side. Marshal Gao Chu asked,
"Are you not the son of Wang Sheng, who used to be a drill instructor of the whole army?"
Wang Jin admitted this.
Marshal Gao Chu then shouted at him, "So it is you! Your father used to sell medicine and exercise the fencing stick to attract a crowd on the street. What military skill have you? But don't be supercilious, because I can court-martial you. You must not dare to presume on your rank and differ from my point of view. On whose influence are you depending? What excuse have you for resting at home?"
Wang Jing answered, "I speak the truth. I am certainly sick and have not yet recovered."
Marshal Gao Jin used abusive language and said, "You banished thief! If you were sick, how could you come here?"
Then Wang Jing said,
"You summoned me here, so I had to come."
Marshal Gao Ju was very angry and shouted an order to the attendants to seize Wang Jin and beat him severely. Among the junior officers, there were many who were friendly with Wang Jin. They therefore joined to plead to Marshal Gao Chu.
"Today is your inauguration day. It is your lucky day. Please forgive this man this time."
Marshal Gao Chu spoke in a loud voice. "You banished thief! These junior officers want me to forgive you. I will speak to you again tomorrow."
Wang Jin confessed his guilt. Holding up his head, he recognized that he was Gao Chu. He left the headquarters and, heaving a sigh, said,
"Just now my life is insecure. This Gao Chu was previously at the capital known as Gao the Second, head of a gang of lazy men. At that time he was learning to use the cudgels, and my father hit him, and for 3 or 4 months he could not get up from a sickbed. Now he has fortunately become Marshal of the Imperial Guard and is eager for revenge. I did not know that he was my superior officer. From ancient times it has been said, 'Fear not the authorities, except those that have authority over you.' There is no help for me."
He returned home in a very melancholy mood. He told his mother about the affair, and they held together and cried,
"My son, of 36 ways of doing a thing, going is the only one that is best. I'm afraid there is no safe place for us."
Wang Jin said,
"What you say, mother, is true. Your son has also thought of this plan. There is at Yanan Prefecture a general who guards the frontier and controls many military officers who used to come to the capital to see me fence. Why should we not now fly to him for refuge? At that place I could get employment and settle down to a quiet life."
Mother and son discussed this matter, and after deciding she said,
"My son, I must go with you secretly, but I'm afraid of the sentries who are stationed outside the door by the headquarters, and we will certainly not be able to get away if they hear of our plans."
Wang Jin said, "Never mind, don't worry, mother. I will arrange matters satisfactorily with them."
Before the sun set, Wang Jin called the sentry Jiang to come inside. He gave him an order.
"After you've had your supper, I want you to go to a place to do something for me."
The sentry inquired where he was to go.
Wang Jin said, "Because of my sickness, I once took a vow to offer sacrifice at the Yu Temple outside the Xuanzao Gate. I wish to be there tomorrow morning and be the first person to burn incense.
I want you to go this evening and inform the head priest of this matter. Tell him to have the doors open early tomorrow morning and wait until I come to burn the first incense.
There shall I present three sacrificial meats to the gods, Lu, Li, and Wang. You must stay at the temple till I come.
Zhang, the sentry, replied, I have already had my supper and will now go to the temple to arrange matters. That night, the mother and son packed their baggage, making two loads for carrying on a pole. They filled two bags with fodder to be tied on the horse and waited until nearly dawn. Then Wang Jin awakened Li, the other sentry, and giving him silver, told him to go to the temple and buy the three meats for the sacrifices, as he himself would buy some yellow candles and would arrive later. Li, the sentry, took the money and departed. Wang Jin saddled the horse and led it out of the stable, fastening the fodder on with ropes and making all tight. He assisted his mother to mount. The furniture, etc., was abandoned. Locking the door, he shouldered his load and followed the horse. It was the fifth watch, about 4 a.m., and was still dark. So, availing themselves of this, they left by the Xihua Gate and travelled quickly toward Yanan Prefecture, Shaanxi Province. The two sentries at the temple bought the meats for the sacrifices, cooked them, and then waited until about 11 a.m. without seeing Wang Jin. Sentry Li became anxious and returned to the house to look for Wang Jin. He found that the doors were locked and he could not enter. After half a day, he saw nobody come. Sentry Zhang stayed at the temple until evening and then returned to the house. They both watched the house during the night without seeing Wang Jin or his mother. The following day, they inquired of Wang's relatives, but no one could be found. They did not wish to be implicated, and therefore reported the matter to the headquarters. Marshal Gao Chu, upon hearing the report, was very angry, and wrote a dispatch instructing the officials in every prefecture and district to arrest Wang Jin. The two sentries were free from all blame. Wang Jin and his mother travelled a good distance from the capital, taking their meals on the way, as chance permitted. They had been on the way over a month, when one evening Wang Jin remarked to his mother, who was riding the horse in front, May heaven have pity on us, and we are now beyond the reach of legal punishment, as although Marshal Gao Chu has ordered my arrest, Yanan Prefecture is not far away. They both felt contented, but they were not aware that they had passed the only available inn. As it grew dusk, however, they saw the glimmer of a light in a forest a good distance away. Wang Jin decided to investigate as to whether they could stay there for the night. He went into the forest and saw a farmyard which was surrounded by a mud wall with about 300 willow trees outside. He knocked at the gate, and when a servant came, he saluted with folded hands. He explained the situation and asked for a night's lodging for his mother and for himself, for which they would pay. The servant went inside to report the matter, and upon his return said the farmer wished to see them. Wang Jin requested his mother to dismount and tied the horse to a tree. He put his load on the threshing floor, and then they followed the servant into the house. The farmer was over 60 years of age, and his hair was all white. He was wearing a warm cap to protect his head from the dust, a loose-fitting gown with a black sash around the waist, and dressed leather boots. Wang Jin saluted, but the farmer said, Friend, don't stand on ceremony. You are travellers in distress. Please be seated. Wang Jin and his mother, observing the rules of propriety, sat down, and in answer to the farmer's questions, Wang Jin explained, My name is Zhang, and I lived in the capital. Business was bad, so I sold all my things, and I'm now on my way to Yanan Prefecture, where I hope to stay with my relatives. Today we have travelled a good distance, but have unfortunately missed the inn. We now wish to stay for the night at your honourable house. The farmer said, Never mind, no man of this world carry houses about with them. Have you dined? He then ordered a servant to bring food. The servants soon arranged a table and carried in trays with four dishes of vegetables and dishes of beef. They placed these on the table and then poured out wine. After exchanging complimentary phrases, they sat down, and after several cups of wine, rice was brought in. When they had finished the meal,
The farmer conducted them to the guest chamber. Wang Jin said, "My mother has ridden the horse a long way, and I suppose that it will be well fed."
"That does not matter," said the farmer. "Here we have many animals, horses and mules, and I have already instructed the servants to look after your horse and feed it well."
Wang Jin thanked him, and then brought his bundles into the chamber. The servants lit a lamp and brought in a tub of hot water for the guests to wash their feet. When the farmer and servants had withdrawn, Wang Jin and his mother retired to rest. They slept till well after daybreak the next day. The farmer came to the door of their room to make inquiries and heard Wang Jin's mother groaning, so he asked what was the matter. Wang Jin told him, "I certainly will not deceive you. My mother was very tired last night and she became sick."
"This being the case, you must not worry," said the farmer. "Tell your mother that she can rest here for a few days. I have a prescription for her sickness, and we'll send a servant into the town for the medicine. Tell her that she will soon be well again."
Wang Jin expressed his thanks. His mother took the medicine, and in about 5 days she was quite well again. On that day, Wang Jin wished to leave and went to the stables to look at the horse. In the yard, he saw a young man with naked body, tattooed all over with 9 dragons and with sleeves turned up. His face was as white as a silver plate. He was about 18 years old and was exercising with a cudgel. Wang Jin watched him for some time and then soliloquized, "You use your cudgels very well, but I think it could be improved, as there are better men than you." The young man was angry upon hearing this and said in a loud voice,
"Who are you? How dare you sneer at my display? I've been trained by about 8 well-known teachers, and I do not think you are their equal. Would you care to fence with me?"
While he was speaking, the farmer came on the scene and said,
"Young man, you are ill-mannered."
He replied, "He should not have laughed at my display."
"Can our guest use the cudgel?" asked the farmer.
"I know a little about it. May I ask who is this young man?"
The farmer replied, "He is my son."
"As he is a young man of this house, I will give him a few lessons if he likes."
"That's very good," said the farmer.
He then summoned his son to come and pay respects to the guest. But he was unwilling to do this, and instead he became very angry. He said,
"Father, do not listen to his stupid talk. If he beats me with the cudgel, then I will pay respects to him as a teacher."
"If you do not believe I can do this, let us have a contest with the cudgels."
The young man walked to the middle of the yard, and picking up a cudgel, whirled it round. He addressed Wang Jin.
"Come on, if afraid, you will be a coward."
Wang Jin only laughed and was unwilling to move. The farmer said,
"If you are willing to instruct my son, what objection have you to using the cudgel?"
Wang Jin laughed.
"I'm afraid that I may hurt your son, and that will not do."
The farmer said, "That does not matter. Even if you break his arm or leg, that will be his own fault."
Wang Jin said, "Forgive me if I make a mistake." He then went to the arms rack, and taking a cudgel, went to the center of the yard and stood on guard. The young man, seeing this, seized his cudgel and went to strike at him. Wang Jin retreated, trailing his cudgel on the ground. The farmer's son flourished his weapon and pursued him. Wang Jin suddenly turned round and delivered a downward blow. Seeing the blow descending, the farmer's son met it with an upward thrust. Wang Jin stayed his blow, drew his cudgel away, and then with a sudden thrust struck the young man on the breast and with a twist knocked the young man's cudgel out of his hand. He fell down on his back, and Wang Jin immediately advanced to lift him, saying,
"Do not blame me, do not get offended."
The farmer's son scrambled up, brought a stool, and requested Wang Jin to be seated. He saluted Wang Jin, saying,
"I have wasted my time with other teachers, but they proved to be unworthy half a cash. Now I have to ask you to be my teacher."
Wang Jin said, "My mother and I have given much trouble to your house for many days. I have no favors to give you, but I can compensate by teaching you."
The farmer was much pleased and told the servants to kill a sheep, prepare a feast with wine and fruit. He also invited Wang Jin's mother to attend the banquet. All four sat down and drank wine together. The farmer stood up with a cup of wine, and addressing Wang Jin said,
Teacher, you are so skillful. You must be an instructor. My son, you have eyes, but have failed to see this eminent person.
Wang Jin laughed. I will not deceive you. I am not Jiang. I am Wang Jin, drill inspector of the Imperial Guard at Kaifeng. Just now a new commander has arrived, Marshal Gao Chu, and because my father once knocked him down with a cudgel and he still harbours resentment against me, as I am his subordinate, I cannot dispute with him, so I take my mother to Yanan Prefecture. It was by chance that I came here and met you. You have treated me well, cured my mother, entertained us, so I felt uneasy of your generosity. If your son is willing to learn, I can teach him. At present, his fencing is only showy and spectacular, but in a real contest, it would be of no use. I will instruct him properly from the beginning.
The farmer insisted on his son paying respects to his new teacher, and said,
You are a first-class instructor. My ancestors lived in this district of Huayin County, close to Mount Shaohua. This is the Shi family village and contains about 400 families of the surname Shi. My son takes interest in playing with lances and cudgels instead of doing farm work. When his mother remonstrated with him, he paid no heed, and she became angry and died. I am unable to control him and do not know how much money he has spent. He engaged a man to teach him and also employed a workman to tattoo 9 dragons on his body, so that the people about here call him Shi Jin with 9 dragons. Drill instructor, you have come here today and completed his training very well. I will amply reward you.
Wang Jin began his lessons from that day, and Shi Jin asked to be taught the 18 subjects of athletics in detail. In a little over half a year, he had mastered these. 1. Use of the lance. 2. The long-handled mallet. 3. The bow. 4. The crossbow. 5. The jingal. 6. The iron whip. 7. The iron truncheon. 8. The two-edged sword. 9. The chain. 10. The hooks. 11. The axe. 12. The battle axe. 13. The three-pronged spear. 14. The halberd. 15. The shield. 16. The cudgel. 17. The spear. 18. The rake. He learned these one by one and became proficient. Wang Jin thought that he could not stay there any longer, although the conditions were suitable. One day he told them that he wished to leave. Shi Jin replied,
Master, you must not think of leaving. I will keep both you and your mother here till your dying days. Will that not be better?
Worthy sir, I have received many favours from you, but I'm afraid that Marshal Guo Qi's men may arrive, and you will be implicated. I must go to Yanan Prefecture, where men are needed. There I can rest and settle.
Shi Jin spoke to his father, and it was agreed that Wang Jin must stay until they had prepared a farewell feast. They presented him 2 rolls of silk and 100 taels of silver. When he left, Shi Jin told one of his men to carry Wang Jin's baggage and accompany him for 10 li, where they parted with tears. Drill instructor Wang again shouldered up his load, and mother and son travelled along the road to the Western Pass. We will now leave Wang Jin and return with Shi Jin to his home. There he continued his drill. In the middle of the night he would practice for 2 hours, and during the day ride his horse outside the village. In less than 6 months, Shi Jin's father died. He prepared a coffin and engaged Buddhist monks to conduct the usual memorial services for 7 days. He also asked a Taoist priest to erect an altar, repeat the funeral services, pray for the safe passage of the soul to heaven, attend at the altar for 10 days, and select a lucky and fortunate time for the funeral and burial. About 400 members of the Shi clan came to the funeral in white mourning clothes, and they buried the dead in the ancestral graveyard in the hills to the west of the village. After this, there was no one at home to manage the property, as Shi Jin only wanted to practice fencing. 3 or 4 months after the death of the farmer, on a hot day in the 6th month, Shi Jin was idling away his time. He placed a bedstead outside on the threshing floor in the shadow of a willow tree, and took rest. A breeze came from the fir trees just opposite. He was enjoying the cool breeze, when all at once he saw a man stealthily spying. He shouted, "What are you doing, and who is there looking round this place?" As he said, he rose, and went to behind a tree to get a better view. He recognized that that man was Li Ji, the rabbit hunter. Shi Jin called, "Li Ji, what are you looking for in my village? Have you come as a spy?" Li Ji stepped forward and said,
"Oh yes, sir, I want to find a man named Qiu Yilang to drink wine with him. But seeing you taking a siesta, I dare not intrude."
"Did you not previously come here selling game, and did I not pay you liberally? So why have you not been here lately with your game? You might think that I had no money." Li Ji replied,
That's not the case. Just now there is no game, and therefore I did not come."
"Stupid talk," said Shi Jin.
"Shaohua is a mountain of vast expanse, and I do not believe that neither deer nor hare can be found there."
Li Ji answered,
"You do not know that there is a band of robbers on the mountain where they've erected a stronghold. They've collected about 700 armed men and over 100 horses. The chief is a man named Zhu Wu, nicknamed Intuitive Strategist, and the second in command is Chen Da, nicknamed Leaping Tiger. The third in command is Yang Chun, nicknamed White Speckled Snake. These three leaders take to robbing houses. They've been officially denounced in Huayin County, and a reward of 3,000 strings of cash has been offered for their capture. But who dare go to arrest them? Even we hunters dare not go to the mountain to shoot games, so how could I come here to sell it?"
"I have heard of these robbers," said Shi Jin, "but I did not know that they had made so much trouble. This being the case, the people certainly dislike them. Li Ji, if you have any game in the future, bring it here." Shi Jin thought this matter over. "These men will certainly come here to plunder." He then told the farm labourers to select 2 fat buffaloes and kill them, and bring the best brew of the village. He sent invitations to all the Shi clan, and upon arrival they seated themselves in order of seniority. Wine was served, and Shi Jin then spoke to the audience, saying,
"I have heard there are 3 robbers on Mount Shaohua, who have altogether about 700 followers, and they rob the people with violence. Sooner or later, they will come and pillage our village. I now invite you here to discuss this matter, so that we may be prepared when they come. I will have a rattle sounded at my house when they arrive, and upon hearing this, you must bring your arms to defend the village. If your families are attacked, we will defend you."
All of them are agreed to what Shi Jin said. They then returned home and prepared their weapons. Shi Jin repaired the defences of the village. At Mount Shaohua, the 3 bandit chiefs were now holding a conference. The leader, Zhu Wu, the intuitive strategist, was a Ding Yuan county man and could fight with a sword in each hand. He was clever in arranging plans for an attack. The second chief, Chen Da, was a Yi Chung county man and was skillful in the use of a steel lance, while the third, Yang Chun, was a Xieliang county man and used a long sword. When they were discussing, Zhu Wu said,
"I have heard that there's a reward offered for anyone who can capture us, and I'm really afraid that when the soldiers come, we shall have a severe struggle with them. But we are short of food, so we must take some for use here. We must collect a large stock of food on the mountain, ready for the time when the soldiers attack us."
Chen Da, the Leaping Tiger, agreed.
"Let us go to Huayin County and ask the people there to lend us some grain, and we can see what they say."
Yang Chung, the White Speckled Snake, remarked,
"There's no need to go there. It'd be better to go to Pucheng County. The chances are 10,000 to 1. We shall not fail there."
Chen Da said,
"There are very few people in Pucheng and very little money or grain there. It'll be better to attack Huayin County. The folk there are wealthy and have abundance of grain."
Yang Chung replied,
"Elder brother, you do not know that if we attack Huayin County, we must pass the village of the Shi clan, where that dangerous fellow Shi Jin with 9 dragons lives, and we must not provoke him. He will not let us pass."
Chen Da said,
"Younger brother, what a coward you are. You're even afraid to pass a village. So what can you do when you're opposed by soldiers?"
"Elder brother, you should not despise Shi Jin. He is hard to deal with."
Zhu Wu said,
I've already heard that he's very brave and is extremely capable. Younger brother, do not go.
Chen Da would not change his mind and said,
You two shut up. Do not increase the other man's determination and reduce our own courage. He's only one man and has not three heads or six arms.
He then called to his armed followers.
Get my horse ready. I will attack the Shi clan village and afterwards seize Huayin County.
Ju Wu remonstrated with him, but Cha Da did not listen. He put on his armour and mounted his horse. He then mustered about 150 armed brigands down the mountain and went with gongs and drums sounding. The brigands' approach was duly reported to Shi Jin, who instantly had the rattles sounded and quickly all the men assembled in arms. Shi Jin wore a towel round his head and was equipped with red mail over an embroidered black wadded coat. On his feet were embroidered green boots and round his waist a leather belt. In front and behind were round metal plates. He carried a bow with quiver full of arrows. In his hand he held a double-edged sword with three sharp spikes at the end and four holes with eight rings attached. He was mounted on a roan horse. Before him were 40 of his retainers, while behind were 90 of the farm labourers. With a combined shout, they all moved towards the north of the village. The brigands halted. Shi Jin saw that Chen Da was in front of his men, wearing a red cap with a concave top, and with iron armour covered with gilt, wadded red clothing, thick army boots, and a plaited waist belt. He rode a white horse and carried a three-pronged halberd, which was about 10 feet long. As the two leaders met, the men raised a loud shout. Chen Da paid his respect to Shi Jin by rising in his stirrups. Shi Jin spoke in a loud voice.
You kill people, set places on fire, rob with violence. Your crimes fill the heavens and you are all deserving of death. You ought to have ears. How dare you come to pouch the tiger's litter?
Cha Den replied from his horse.
We are short of grain at our mountain fortress and are going to borrow some grain at Huayin County. We have taken a short cut by passing your honourable village, but we will not disturb even a blade of grass here. Let us pass, and on our return we will thank you.
Nonsense, replied Shi Jin. I am the head of this village and I must arrest you. If I don't do so, I shall be implicated, and the magistrate will blame me.
Within the four seas, all men are brothers, so let us use your road, said Chen Da.
What meaningless talk, said Shi Jin. Even if I am willing, but there is one who is not, so you must have his consent before you pass.
You are a hero. Tell me whom I must ask, replied Chen Da.
You can ask the sword in my hand, and if it is willing, then you can pass, said Shi Jin.
Chen Da spoke angrily.
You are trying to deceive me, but you should not be presumptuous.
Shi Jin was also angry, and brandishing his sword, he rode forward to fight. Chen Da whipped his horse, thrust forward his three-pronged halberd, and advanced to meet Shi Jin. They fought for some time. Then Shi Jin thought of a plan, and purposely allowed Chen Da to thrust in his halberd. He parried the blow by moving to one side, as Chen Da lunged forward. With a dexterous turn of the arm, he caught Chen Da and pulled him out of his saddle. Then he took hold of his plaited waist belt and threw him to the ground. The horse galloped away like a gust of wind. Shi Jin told his servants to bind Chen Da, and the band of robbers scattered. Shi Jin returned to his house and bound Chen Da to a pillar in the hall to wait until he captured the other robber chiefs so as to send them together to the magistrate's yamen to be dealt with. He gave wine to all the villagers and then dismissed them. Everyone applauded him and said, You, sir, are a hero. We will not say anything more about the feast at the Shi clan village, but let us consider the anxiety of Ju Wu and Yang Chun in their mountain stronghold. They had sent many soldiers to make inquiries, and on the way they met the men returning with the riderless horse. The defeated men said,
Bad luck. Our elder brother's life is in danger.
Upon reaching the stronghold, they gave details of the fight, saying, Shi Jin was a great hero.
Shall we risk our lives in rescuing him? Asked Yang Chun.
We cannot do that, replied Ju Wu. The disaster is of his own making. How can we defeat Shi Jin? I have a desperate plan, but if we fail to rescue Chen Da, then that will be the end of all of us.
Ju Wu whispered his plan.
Yang Chun said, Good, let us go without delay.
Now, in the village, Shi Jin's anger had not abated when a labourer rushed in and reported that the other robber chiefs had come. Shi Jin said,
I will send them both to the magistrate. Bring me my horse.
The rattle was sounded, and the same crowd of armed men assembled. He was just on the point of leaving when he saw the two robber chiefs walking to the gate. They both knelt down and cried. Shi Jin dismounted and shouted, What have you to say?
Ju Wu, crying, answered, We shall be arrested and tried and cannot live as bandits on the mountains. Once we took a vow that we would die on the same day, although we have not the heroism of Guan Gong, Jiang Fei, and Liu Bei, yet we have the same objects in mind. Today, our brother Chen Da did not listen to our advice, but he unintentionally offended your dignity. You, hero, have already arrested him at your noble village. As we have no alternative, we come only to beseech you to put us to death together. We hope that you, hero, will send us three men to the magistrate and ask for a reward. We swear that we shall not feel sorrow at that. We are entirely in your hands and wish to die.
Shi Jin heard this and thought that they were brave. If he sent them to the magistrate and requested a reward, then all heroes would be ashamed of him for not being a brave man. The ancients said, The tiger does not eat the flesh of a tiger. So he said to these men, Come inside. They were not afraid and followed Shi Jin into the hall, where they knelt and asked him to bind them. Shi Jin told them several times to rise, but they declined to do so. He thought, Intelligent people like intelligence in others, and so good folk recognize the good in others. He said,
As your bravery is so great, I cannot send you to the magistrate. How will it be if I release Chen Da?
We do not wish to implicate you, said Ju Wu. It will be better for you to ask for the reward.
How can I do that? Said Shi Jin. Are you willing to eat my food and drink wine?
We are not even afraid of death, so how can we be afraid of meat and drink?
Shi Jin was much pleased at this and released Chen Da. He invited all three to dine with him, and they expressed their thanks for his great benevolence. After drinking several cups of wine, they departed. As a token of thankfulness, the three brigand chiefs got together 30 taels of gold in ingots, which was sent in a dark, moonless night by two of their men to Shi Jin. When the bandits arrived at the farm, Shi Jin came to the gate to inquire what they wanted, and they presented the gold and asked him to accept the same. At first, Shi Jin refused to accept the gift, but he saw that the intention was good, so he accepted the gold and then ordered a servant to give the men refreshments. When they departed, he gave them some small pieces of silver for themselves. A fortnight afterwards, the bandit leaders took a big jewel which they had looted some time before and sent it to Shi Jin, who accepted it. He saw that they were grateful for his mercy, so he had three gowns made with red embroidered silk, and sent these with some wine and three fat roasted sheep to the brigands, and his steward, Wang the Fourth, was put in charge of this matter. Shi Jin and the brigands became very friendly and were frequently giving each other presents. On the 15th day of the 8th month, Shi Jin sent Wang the Fourth with an invitation for a banquet, and the bandit chiefs wrote a reply accepting the invitation. After a few cups of wine, Wang the Fourth left, but on his way down the mountain he met some brigands who took him to an inn where he drank more wine. When he left, he was slightly drunk and staggered along. After going about 3 li, he came to a forest, which he entered and lay down in the long grass to sleep. The hunter, Li Ji, came to that spot to look for hares, and recognizing Wang the Fourth, he attempted to raise him up, but he could not do so. In doing this, some silver fell out from Wang the Fourth's girdle, which made Li Ji meditate.
This man is drunk, but where did the money come from? Why should I not take some?
It was now the opportunity for the baneful forces to come together,
so unexpected events ensued naturally. He unloosed Wang the Fourth's girdle, and upon shaking it, the sealed reply from the bandits fell out. He opened that, and recognized the names of the brigand chiefs.
Here's my luck. A fortune teller told me that I should have great fortune, and here it is. A reward is offered for their arrest, and perhaps I can get something for this letter also.
So he took the silver and the letter, and went to report the matter to the officials at Waiyin County. When Wang the Fourth awoke that evening, the moon was shining through the trees. He found his girdle in the grass, but the silver and the letter were missing. He felt greatly annoyed and thought the matter over. He thought that if he said he had lost the letter, Shi Jin would probably dismiss him. So at last he decided to say that the invitation had been accepted, but there was no written reply. He told this to Shi Jin, who asked why he had been so long in returning, and he explained that the bandits had pressed him to stay, drinking wine for half the night. On the day appointed, Shi Jin had a banquet prepared, and the three bandit leaders duly arrived, with about 5 armed men. They took their seats. But when they had drunk much wine, there was a loud noise and much torchlight outside the gate. Shi Jin was startled, and jumping up told the brigands to keep their seats while he went out to see what had happened. He told the servants not to open the gate, and putting a ladder against the wall he looked over. He saw that the county police inspector was on a horse, 2 constables and about 400 soldiers surrounded the farm. He returned, and told the bandits that the soldiers had come evidently to arrest them. Men concealed in the deep of reeds prepared their boats among the lotus leaves. Soldiers sent to capture them did only make them intimate. We will now relate how the brigands made their escape. Chapter 2. Shi Jin leaves during the night. Major Lu Da assaults Butcher Zheng. The bandit chiefs knelt down, saying, "Elder brother, you are guiltless and we do not wish to involve you. You can take a rope and bind us and ask for the reward."
"That will not do," said Shi Jin. "I invited you to come here, and if I seize you for the reward, everybody will jeer at me. If this is your time for death, I will die with you. If to live, then I will live with you. Please get up, be at your ease, and let us think of another plan. Wait until I have asked the soldiers why they come here."
Shi Jin climbed the ladder and called out,
"Why do you men come here in the third watch of the night?"
The inspector replied,
"Sir, you need not say that you are not guilty, as we have the accuser Li Ji here."
Shi Jin shouted,
"Li Ji? Why do you falsely accuse an innocent person?"
I really do not know," replied Li Ji. "In a forest I got a letter from Wang the Fourth, and the same day I read it before the Yaman, and this is the result."
Shi Jin addressed Wang the Fourth.
"You said there was no reply, so how is this?"
"Oh, I forgot the letter because I was drunk," answered Wang the Fourth.
Shi Jin shouted,
"You brute!"
The inspector outside was afraid of Shi Jin and dared not enter the farm to arrest the men. The three bandit chiefs pointed their fingers and said to Shi Jin,
"Speak only to those outside."
Shi Jin understood and said,
"You 2 constables need not use force. I will give them over, and you can escort them to the Yamen, where you can ask for the reward."
The 2 constables replied,
"We have no business here. We're waiting for you to come out and go with us to get the reward."
Shi Jin descended the ladder, and catching Wang the Fourth, took him into the garden and killed him with a sword. He then ordered the servants to pack up all the valuables and light about 40 torches. He and the 3 bandit chiefs armed themselves, 1 sword in the hand and a smaller one in their waist. They set fire to the huts at the back of the farmstead, and the soldiers immediately rushed there. Shi Ji set fire to the building in the center of the enclosure. He opened the gates and called to his men to kill anyone they met. He was in the front. Ju Wu and Yang Chun were in the middle, and Chen Da was at the rear. They went out, killing men on both sides. Shi Jin was like a tiger, and nobody could stop him. They hacked their way through the cordon of soldiers. Afterwards, they came across the 2 constables and Li Ji. When enemies meet, they recognize each other clearly. The inspector, seeing that Shi Jin was angry, ran away. Li Ji also turned to run, but Shi Jin caught him, and with a slash, he cut him in half with his sword. The bandit chiefs pursued the constables and dispatched them. The troops scattered in every direction. Shi Jin led his men straight to Mount Shouahua, where there was a feast to celebrate the occasion. After staying a few days, Shi Jin considered the position. He had saved the lives of three men and some valuables, but his homestead and his property had all been destroyed. Evidently, he could not stay there, so he told the bandit chiefs that he wished to go to find his old drill instructor, Wang Jin. The bandits urged him to stay and promised to erect new buildings for him, but Shi Jin would not agree to this. Then Zhu Wu said they would make him their chief, and quite happy. "I am an innocent man, so how could I defile this body bequeathed to me by my parents? You need not persuade me to become a bandit." After a few days, Shi Jin still wanted to go, but the bandit chiefs were equally determined to keep him. Nothing could stop Shi Jin, and he prepared to depart. He put on a broad-brimmed hat with a big red tassel, under it a black cloth with the corners hanging down, and a bright yellow ribbon outside. He also wore a military overcoat arranged on two sides. Around his waist was a girdle of plaited bands of red plum colour. Black and white puttees wound tightly round his legs. His shoes were made of hemp, specially suitable for hilly roads. He carried a swan feather sword with a round copper knob on the shaft and a bundle on his back. He took leave of the three bandit chiefs and descended the mountain accompanied by a large number of the bandits. The bandit chiefs shed tears when he left them. Shi Jin took the direct road to Yanan Prefecture. He took his meals when convenient and travelled during the day and slept at night. Travelling alone, he reached Weizhou in a little over a fortnight. He thought that as this place was a military station, he would inquire about his teacher, drill instructor Wang Jin. Upon entering the town, he saw that there were many roads and much business. He found a tea shop on the roadside, where he stopped and ordered tea. He asked the waiter where the military yamen was. While they were talking, a big man came in with big strides. This man wore military dress. On his head was a piece of silk, with the character 1, and attached at the back were two golden rings, inscribed Tai Yuan Prefecture. He wore a large military coat of parrot green colour, with a military belt in black. His boots were made of yellow leather with 4 seams. He had a round face, big ears, a prominent nose, a big mouth, and a bushy beard. He was quite 8 feet high and a girth of 50 inches. As he sat down, the waiter said that Shi Jin might ask this officer about the drill instructor. Shi Jin stood up and said, "Will you please drink tea with me?" The man also saluted, and when they both sat down, Shi Jin asked for his name.
"I am Major Lu Da. May I ask your name?"
"I am from Huaihin County, and my name is Shi Jin. I wish to ask whether you know a drill instructor called Wang Jin."
Lu Da said, "Brother, are you not the tattooed dragon's Shi Jin out of the Shi village?"
Shi Jin admitted this, and the officer again saluted and said that he had heard of him, but to meet him was much better than hearing. He then said that drill instructor Wang Jin held office under Old Zhong, the frontier general at Yanan Prefecture. As he was the Shi Jin of whom he had heard so much, he invited him to have a drink with him. The two men left the tea house hand in hand, and after turning several corners, they went into a well-known wine shop of the Pan family. Finding a cozy room upstairs, they sat down. Major Lu Da ordered 4 pots of wine, with dishes of eatables and fruit, and they chatted about the various forms of using the lance. While they were talking, they heard someone sobbing and crying in an adjoining room. This disturbed Major Lu Da, who took a cup and saucer and threw them on the floor. The waiter heard the noise and saw that the major was angry. The major inquired who it was that was crying and disturbing them. The waiter said,
"Oh, there is a sing-song girl with her father, and they're crying because there's no guest to engage them, and they do not know you are here."
"But why do they make this noise?" said the major. "Tell them to come here."
The waiter left, and in a short time a woman entered, of about 19 years of age, and behind her there was an old man of 60 years, with castanets in his hand. The woman was not beautiful, yet there was something attractive about her. Wiping away her tears, she came forward and gave a woman's salutation, one hand placed on top of the other. The major asked why they cried, and she replied, "I am from Kaifeng, and I came to this place with my parents to find some relatives, but upon arrival, we found they had moved to Nanjing. My mother was taken ill in an inn and died. My father and myself stayed here in distress. There is a wealthy man here nicknamed the Bully of the Western Pass. When he saw me, he sent a matchmaker to demand me to be his concubine. A bond was drawn up that he would give me 3,000 strings of cash for my body, which I accepted as I thought he would keep his word. In less than 3 months, his legal wife treated me very badly and turned me out of doors. Besides, they demanded me to return the 3,000 strings of cash which I had never received, but which they said I had received when I pawned my body. My father was timid and dared not dispute with the bully who was so influential. But as he has not paid me a single cash, how can we return him the money? Now, as when I was a small girl, my father taught me to use the castanet, so we came to this wine shop to entertain the customers. Every day, the money we got was paid more than half to the bully, and we had only a little for ourselves. For the last 2 days, there were very few guests, and we have passed the time limit he allowed us. When we thought of our trouble, we were distressed. We had no thought of intruding upon your attention, and hope you will overlook our offence."
Major Lu Da asked for their names and where this bully lived. The old man replied, "My name is Jin, and the baby name of my daughter is Quilian. The bully keeps a butcher's shop near the Zhuangyuan Bridge. We two live at the Lu family inn near the East Gate."
Upon hearing this, Major Lu Da expressed his disgust.
"Ah, I know that fellow. He was previously a butcher and is a filthy rascal. Some time ago he asked my help in getting the garrison commander here to permit him to open his shop, and this is how he cheats people. I will go and kill him."
Shi Jin exhorted him repeatedly to wait till the morrow, but there was no alteration. Major Lu Da said,
"Old man, come here. If we give you your travelling expenses, will you return to Kaifeng tomorrow?"
The father and daughter replied, "If we could return to our native village, we should look upon you as our parent for this new life. But will the proprietor of our inn let us go? If we go, the bully will certainly demand the money from the inn proprietor." Major Lu Da said that this was not important, as he had a plan. He took 5 taels of silver from his pocket and put them on the table, and then asked Shi Jin if he could lend him some money till the following day. Shi Jin did not want repayment and placed an ingot of 10 taels of silver on the table. Major Lu Da gave this money to the old man, Jin, and told him to make his arrangements at the inn, and he would come early the following morning to send them off. They gave their thanks and departed. Old Jean went outside the town and hired a cart for the following day. They paid the inn for the lodging. They packed their baggage and waited for daybreak. About 4 o'clock, he lit a fire and cooked some food for breakfast. Shortly after daybreak, Major Lu Da arrived and told them to go quickly. As they moved towards the door, the waiter stopped them and explained to the major that the money for the pawning of the body was still unpaid, and the bully had ordered him to watch them. Major Lu Da said that he himself would pay that to the butcher. But as the waiter was unwilling to let them go, the major slapped his face so that the blood flowed from his mouth. He knocked his 2 teeth out with his fist. The waiter rushed out of the inn, and the old man Jean with his daughter quickly left. Major Lu Da thought the waiter might intercept them, so he sat down on a stool and waited there for 2 hours. When he thought Jean had gone some distance, he got up and walked to the Zhuanyuan Bridge. The butcher had a double-fronted shop, 2 butcher's blocks, and about 5 sides of pork hanging. The butcher was behind the counter, watching his 10 assistants selling the meat. When Major Lu Da arrived, he stood outside the door and called to the butcher, who came and saluted with folded hands. He said,
"Excuse me,"
and then told an assistant to bring a stool for the major, who sat down, saying,
"I have an order from the garrison commander for 13 jin of lean minced pork. He does not want the least fat in it."
The butcher told his assistants to get it ready, but the major objected.
"Do not let those dirty men handle the meat. You cut it yourself." "Very well," said the butcher. "I will cut it myself."
He then got to the block, selected 10 jin of lean pork, and cut it into small pieces. The waiter of the inn just then arrived with a towel wrapped round his head. When he saw Major Lu Da, He dare not come nearer, so he stood under the eaves of a house some distance away. It took the butcher quite half an hour to cut the meat. He then wrapped it in lotus leaves and asked if he should send it.
"Send what?" asked Major Lu Dar. "Wait, I want another 13 jin, and it must be all fat. There must not be any lean flesh with it. It must also be minced."
"But it's now all lean pork," said the butcher. "I'm afraid that the commander wants to make pork pies. What use is there for minced fat?"
Major Lu Dar stared at the butcher and said,
"The commander gave me the order, so who dare ask questions?"
The butcher said,
"No matter what purpose it's intended for, I will cut it up."
He then selected 10 jin of the finest fat pork, minced it, and placed it in a lotus leaf. He'd been cutting the pork almost all the morning, and it was now near the dinner hour. The butcher said,
"Shall I tell someone to go with you to carry this to the magistrate?"
Major Lu Dar replied,
"I also want 10 jin of gristle to be chopped fine. There must be no flesh attached to it."
The butcher laughed and said,
"It appears as though you had specially come to waste my time."
Major Lu Dar, upon hearing this, got up and, staring at the butcher, said,
"I certainly came to waste your time."
He then picked up the two parcels of pork and threw them into the butcher's face, the minced pork falling like a shower of rain. The butcher was very angry, and his passion pervaded his body from his feet to the crown of his head. His heart became a burning mass of passions which could not be extinguished. He seized a sharp, pointed knife and jumped out of the shop. Major Lu Dar had got into the street before him. There was a crowd of neighbours, but nobody dared intervene. The passers-by and the waiter from the inn were frightened out of their wits. The butcher had the knife in his right hand, and with his left he tried to seize Lu Dar. But the major caught his left arm and kicked him in the groin so that he fell in the street. The major took a step forward and placed his foot on the butcher's breast. He raised his fist, which was as large as a monk's alms bowl, and said,
"Now you are a butcher and are like a dog. Why did you swindle the jin's girl, Kui Lin?"
He struck a blow on the butcher's nose, which was broken and twisted to one side. The blood was gushing forth like the breaking of a sauce bottle. The butcher could not rise, and throwing aside his knife, said,
"Enough."
Major Lu Dar abused him, saying,
"You thieving bastard, how dare you reply?"
Then, lifting his fist, he struck the butcher in the corner of his eye such a blow that the eyeball fell out with a display of red, black, and purple colours on his cheeks. The butcher asked to be pardoned, but Major Lu Dar shouted,
"You are a bad lot. If you were sincere, I would forgive you, but I cannot do so."
He thereupon hit him on the temple, and it seemed to the butcher as though a whole temple of priests were chanting their prayers, ringing bells and clapping cymbals. The major saw that the butcher was exhaling without any intake, so he falsely spoke to him,
"You are pretending to die."
But he saw that his skin was gradually becoming pale, and he could hardly believe that three blows of his fist could have killed the man. He knew that he would be prosecuted, so he decided to go away. As he left, he saw the butcher was dead. As he went along, he turned around and abused the butcher, but the onlookers dared not interfere. Returning to his lodging, the major packed a few things and silver, and taking a cudgel, he quickly left the town by the south gate. The people tried to revive the body for half a day without success, for, alas, he was quite dead. The members of the family went to the yamen, and when the magistrate came, made their accusation. The magistrate thought that as Major Lu Dar was a military officer, he had better report to the garrison commander. So at once he got in a sedan chair and went to the headquarters. When they met, the magistrate saluted. Then he stated that Major Lu Dar had killed a man, but he dared not arrest him without the general's consent. The general was startled at the news, and after some thought, he asked the magistrate to arrest and try him according to the law. As Major Lu Dar was still on the staff of the old General Zheng from the frontier, the sentence should be submitted to the latter for confirmation. The magistrate agreed to do this, and upon returning to his yamen, he took his seat on the bench and issued a warrant for the arrest of Major Lu Dar. The inspector who received the warrant proceeded to the lodgings of the major, but he found no clue there. Moreover, as he did not know where he had gone, he he arrested the landlord and two of the neighbours. The magistrate sent these men temporarily to the detention house and ordered the coroner to make a careful post-mortem examination of the corpse, then have the body placed in a coffin and deposited it in the courtyard of a temple, awaiting further developments. He then issued a proclamation giving details of the murder, a full description of the major, with a reward of 1,000 strings of cash for his arrest. This was printed and posted in public places in every district. Lu Da travelled hastily, without any definite object in view. When hungry, he took any food that was ready. When cold, any clothing available. Hurrying, he did not choose road. And being poor, he would have taken any woman as his wife. In just more than a fortnight, he reached Yanmen County in the Dezhou Prefecture, and entering the town on a market day, he found that the streets were crowded and noisy. Horses and carts were passing along side by side. There were all kinds of traders selling and buying goods from all parts. Although it was only a county town, yet it was better than many a prefectural capital for business. Arriving at the crossroads, he saw a crowd looking at a proclamation. He forced his way through the crowd, but as he could not read, he listened to one man who was reading it aloud. It was the proclamation about himself, warning the people not to harbour him and offering a reward for his arrest. When he had listened to this, he heard a voice behind him say, "Elder brother Zhang, what are you doing here?" He was then pulled away from the crossroads. We will now relate how Lu Da had his head shaved and his beard cut off, changed his name, and destroyed a Buddhist disciple. His staff cleared the roads from danger. His sword killed the vicious people. Chapter 3. Zhao Yuanwai rebuilds Wenshu Monastery. Lu Da makes a row at Mount Wutai. When Lu Da turned round, he saw that it was old Jin of the wine shop at Weizhou who was pulling him. They went to a quiet spot, where the old man said, "Benefactor, you are too brave. That proclamation orders your arrest, and yet you go to look at it. If I had not seen you, you might have been recognized by a minor official."
"I will tell you the truth," said Lu Da. "Because of your affair, I killed a bully, and I have been wandering about for 50 days, and did not plan to come here. Why did you not return to Kaifeng as it was arranged?"
Old Jin said, "My superior benefactor, on the day you saved me, I hired a cart and left with the intention of returning to Kaifeng, but on the way I met an old neighbour of ours who was coming here to do business as a merchant, and he brought us here. Fortunately, he arranged a marriage for my daughter with a wealthy man, Zhao Yuanwai, who kept her as a concubine. My daughter is always telling him of your benevolence, and he says that he would like to meet you. Let us go and see them now."
They went about half a li to the house of Zhao, where old Jin lifted the curtain in front of the door and called out,
"Daughter, our benefactor has arrived."
She came outside and invited Lu Da to enter and sit down. She then gave him 6 salutations and asked them to go upstairs. He wished to leave, but old Jin took his staff and bundle and said to his daughter,
"Please take our benefactor upstairs and I will go to arrange the food."
He then went with a servant and brought some fresh fish, a tender chicken, a goose cured in wine, and some pickled fish. Upon returning, he had these cooked and taken upstairs. The girl servant brought the hot wine in a silver pot, and father and daughter took it in turn to fill up Lu Da's cup.
Old Jin knelt and made his obeisance. "Why do you pay me such respect?" exclaimed Major Lu Da. "You lessen my prospects in life."
"Benefactor, please listen. I have been here a short time, but I wrote your name on a piece of red paper, and every morning I burn a stick of incense and made obeisance to it. Now that you are here in person, why should I not do the same to you?"
In the evening, they heard a noise below. Major Lu then opened the window and looked down. He saw about 30 men armed with wooden sticks and cudgels, who were calling out,
"Bring down the man from upstairs!"
Among them was an official on horseback, who was shouting,
"I do not want this thief to escape."
Upon hearing this, Lu Da took a stool and was going to dash down to fight. Old Jin called,
"You need not fight about this."
He then descended and went to the official and spoke to him a few words. The official laughed and dismissed the men. He dismounted and went indoors. Old Jean requested Major Lu Da to come down. The official was Zhao Yuanwai, who knelt, kowtowed, saying, "To learn of your name is not so good as to see your face. To see your face is better than knowing your name. Famous Major, please receive my obeisances." Lu Da asked Old Jean, "Who is this person? We are not acquainted. Why does he make obeisance?" Old Jean replied, "This is my daughter's husband. He suspected that I had brought an outsider here to drink wine. Therefore, he brought his servant to beat him. When I told him the truth, he sent his men away." Major Lu and the others went upstairs and sat down. Zhao Yuanwei said, "I wish to express my respect to you at this time. I've heard a great deal of your heroism, and today heaven has granted me this meeting." The major said, "I am very stupid and am deserving death. If you do not mind my poverty and misfortune, we shall become close friends, and if you have anything to do, I shall be willing to serve you." Zhao Yuanwei was much pleased and inquired about the murder. They chatted and compared notes about fencing with lances. They drank wine to midnight and then went to rest. The next day, Zhao Yuanwai remarked, "I do not consider this place is safe, so I decided to take you to my native village, which is 3 li from town." He sent a man to the village to bring a horse, which Lu Da mounted, and the farm servant was asked to carry the baggage. They took leave of Old Jean and his daughter, and as they rode abreast, they chatted. The next day, Lu Da said, at a feast, "You are treating me well, and I am not able to return your kindness." Zhao Yuanwei replied, "Within the four seas, all men are brothers, so why mention returning the kindness?" Lu Da stayed there for a week. One day, Old Jean hurriedly arrived and told Lu Da,
"Benefactor, I have a suspicion because of that affair the other day. The neighbors talked about it, and yesterday 4 policemen came making inquiries. I am afraid that they will come here and arrest you."
Lu Da said that he had better go, and Zhao Yuanwei replied,
"I have another plan. I will find a peaceful retreat for you, if you would agree to go."
Lu Da asked where that place was, and Zhao Yuanwei said,
"About 10 li from here is a mountain called Mount Wutai, and on it is a monastery called Wenshu Monastery. This was the earthly abode of the bodhisattva Wenshu, and now there are about 700 monks in the monastery. The abbot's name is Ji Jen, and he is a close friend of mine. An ancestor of mine endowed the monastery. I once took the vow that I would subsidize a monk there. I have purchased the certificate, monk's gown, and alms bowl. I have no trusty person who would fulfill my wish, but if you would care to do so, I will arrange matters for you. Are you willing to have your hair cut off and become a monk?"
Lu Da thought the matter over.
"Now I must leave here, but where can I go? I had better do as you suggest."
So he said,
"I accept your offer and will become a monk. I have confidence in you."
During the night, they arranged matters and prepared the clothes, travelling expenses, rolls of silk, and other gifts for the temple. They rose early the next morning and called servants to carry the articles. They started at 7 o'clock and reached the foot of the mountain at 11. There they engaged 2 sedan chairs to take them up the mountain, and the servant was sent in advance to announce their arrival. They were met at the monastery by the manager and superintendent of that monastery, and were conducted to a pavilion outside the temple gate, where the abbot came with his attendants to welcome them. After a little while, the abbot took them to his private room for tea. Abbot Ji Jen requested Zhao Yuanwei to take the seat of honour. Lu Da took a monk's seat and sat down in a lower position. Zhao leaned over and whispered in Lu Da's ear,
"You have come here to become a monk. How can you sit down opposite to the abbot?" "I do not understand their customs," said Lu Da.
He then rose and took his position at the side of the squire. In front of them stood the chief monk, the Wei Na, the abbot's assistant, the superintendent of the temple and his assistant, the guest's host, and the scribe, in order of rank. The servants brought in the box containing the gifts and placed it in front of the abbot, who said,
"Why have you brought presents again? We have plenty of your donations in this monastery."
The servants and the acolytes removed the gifts. And then Zhao Yuanwei stood up and said, "Previously I wished to subsidize a monk here. I had the certificate, but up to now I have not found the proper man. My cousin, Lu Da, was a military officer at Weizhou, but he saw the misery of the present generation and has rejected the common lot. He begs the abbot to have mercy and receive him as a monk. I would prepare all the articles for him. I have great hopes that the abbot will satisfy his desire." The abbot, upon hearing this, replied, "This will bring glory to our monastery. Can be easily arranged." He then told the acolyte to serve tea, which was done. After tea, the abbot discussed with the Wei Na the question of cutting off Lu Da's hair and making him a monk. He ordered the superintendent to supply the plain food for his fasting. He told all the other monks to be present to discuss the matter with their brothers. They did this, and the general opinion was that Lu Da had not the appearance of a monk, and moreover his eyes looked cruel. They asked the guest's host to request Lu Da to sit at another place so that they could talk this matter over with the abbot. The host invited Zhao Yuanwei and Lu Da to go with him to the guest chamber. The monks addressed the abbot, saying, "This man who wishes to become a monk has a repulsive and cruel appearance, and we cannot shave him. We are afraid afterwards our monastery will be disgraced." The abbot answered, "He is a cousin of our donor Zhao Yuanwei. How dare we offend him? You should not suspect him. You can wait here and let me have a look at his features." He then burnt a stick of incense, placing it in the vase for that purpose. He sat down, cross-legged, in a monk's meditation, and began to chant. When the stick of incense was finished, he returned to the other room and said to the monks, "You may now shave his head. He is a representation of a heavenly star, and he is quite upright. At present, he is cruel, but his future is favorable, and he will become pure. In the process of transmigration, he has become uncommon, and is better than any of you. You must remember what I say, and accept it." The chief monk answered, "As you connive at his faults, so we have no alternative but to obey. If we reprove him, then we are not obeying you." The abbot ordered the common food to be prepared, and invited Zhao Yuanwei and Lu Da to dine with him. After the meal, the superintendent opened the donations book, and Zhao Yuanwei gave some money, telling him to buy things necessary for a monk. In 2 days, they were ready, and the abbot selected a lucky time and day, and at that time the bells and drums were beaten, and the monks assembled in the great hall. There were altogether about 600, wearing their surplices, and they knelt down in an attitude of prayer, in two rows, before the abbot's throne. Zhao Yuanwei brought silver paper money and kowtowed before the abbot. He stated the case clearly, and then the acolytes led in Lu Da. The Wei Na told Lu Da to remove his hat, let his hair down in 9 plaits, and then fold it on the top of his head. The barber shaved the head all round, including the moustache and beard. Lu Da asked, "Would it not be better if you leave me just a little?" Upon hearing this, the assembled monks could not help laughing. The abbot from his throne addressed them, "Let all listen to this. Shave him clean of every hair. Leave not e'en a root. Cleanly shave the young monk's head, so no strife may shoot." The abbot exclaimed loudly, "Shave it all off." The barber took his knife and shaved what was left. The abbot's assistant, holding aloft the certificate, brought it before the throne and requested the abbot to bestow a new name. The abbot, taking the certificate, said, "Priceless is the holy light. Silver buys it not. Buddha's laws are very broad. Thy name is wise and deep." The certificate was then handed to the recorder, who completed the entries and then gave it to Lu Da. The abbot ordered that the priestly robes and the surplice be issued to the novitiate. The superintendent then conducted Lu Da to the throne, and the abbot placed his hands on the new monk's head, saying, "First, you must conform to the laws of Buddhism. Second,
you must observe the rules of the order. Third, you must be friendly to the monks. These are the three rules to obey. But there are also five prohibitions as follows. You must not take life, steal, fornicate, covet wine, or speak falsely. Lu Da expressed his assent and said he would not forget them. Upon hearing this statement, the monks laughed. After the ceremony, Zhao Yuanwei invited all the monks to accompany him to the Cloud Hall, where he burnt incense and then dined with them. He gave presents to all the officials of the monastery. Lu Da was conducted by the superintendent, and the monks all kowtowed to him. The following day, Zhao Yuanwei wished to return home, and after breakfast, a large number of monks accompanied him to the main entrance, where, after saluting, he addressed them. Let all display mercy. Your younger brother, wise and deep, Ji Shen, is very stupid, and he speaks foolishly. He does not understand etiquette, and may unintentionally break your rules. I request you to forgive his faults on my account.
Never mind, replied the abbot. I myself will teach him to read and chant the classics, and discuss the truth with him in the prayer hall. Zhao promised to recompense the kind treatment. He beckoned Lu Da to a fir tree, where he said, Worthy brother, from today your life will improve, but at all times you must not forget your weakness, and not be so confident of yourself. If there is any further trouble, it will be difficult for us to see each other, so take care. By and by I will send a man with clothing for you. Lu Da promised to follow his advice, and then Zhao Yuanwei took leave of the abbot and the crowd of monks. And down the mountain he departed. Lu Da went to the monk's dormitory and lay down to sleep. On either side of him was a monk, and they both pushed him, saying, Get up, this won't do. As you have left home, why do you not sleep in a sitting position?
I am going to sleep, and what is that to do with you?
Answered Lu Da. A monk exclaimed,
What a calamity!
Lu Da shouted,
Even a tortoise I shall eat. What calamity will there be?
The monk replied,
Of course there will be a calamity.
Lu Da said, A tortoise has a big belly, but the fat is sweet and nice to eat. So why should there be a calamity?
The monks took no more notice of him and let him sleep. The next day they wanted to report to the abbot that Lu Da had been unreasonable. But the abbot's assistant advised them not to interfere, as the abbot would only protect him. Lu Da saw that nobody spoke to him, and therefore every evening he went to rest. He lay aslant across the bed. During the night, he snored like thunder and made great noises. He pissed and shit behind one of the halls. An attendant reported to the abbot that Lu Da had bad manners and did not observe the customs of a monk. The abbot shouted,
Nonsense, you must not forget the donor. I expect there will be an improvement later.
After this, no one dared speak about Lu Da. Lu Da lived at the Mount Wutai Monastery for about 5 months, without noticing the time pass. But upon winter coming, he thought of leaving. At that time the weather was fine, so he wore a long black gown with a black belt, changed his monk's shoes, and walked down the hill. About halfway, he sat down in an arbour and meditated.
What a glutton I am! Previously I liked good wine and meat and never restrained my appetite. Now I have been trained as a monk, and I am hungry and thirsty. Zhao Yuanwei has not sent me any food for several days, and I feel ravenous. I should like some good wine.
Just then he saw in the distance a young man carrying two buckets on a pole and singing as he ascended the mountain path. The buckets were covered with lids. He had in his hand a bowl and sang,
On the battlefield of Mount Juili, a herd boy got a sword and spear. From the days of long ago, a fair wind ruffles the waters near where the river Wu sings the hero's song of Chang Yu's wife and her farewell woe.
Upon reaching the arbour, the man put down his load, and Lu Da asked what the buckets held, and he was told it was wine.
What is the price for one bucket?
Asked Lu Da.
Reverend, are you joking?
Asked the man.
Why should I joke with you? Said Lu Da.
The man answered, I am taking this wine up the mountain to sell it to the cooks, messengers, sedan chair carriers, and other servants at the monastery. The abbot has given an order that if we sell any wine to a monk, he will punish us, take our money, and expel us from the monastery. The abbot gave me the capital to buy the wine, and I live in the monastery, so how dare I sell wine to you?
But why cannot you sell? Asked Ludar.
Kill me, and still I will not sell, replied the man.
I won't kill you, said Ludar. I'm only asking you to sell the wine.
The man saw that trouble was brewing, so he picked up his load and walked away. Ludar quickly left the arbour, took hold of the carrying pole, and kicked the man in the groin. The fellow clasped his hand over the injured part, crouched upon the ground, and did not rise for a long time. Ludar seized the two buckets of wine and took them into the arbour. He opened the buckets, and ladling out the cold wine, drank it. In a little time, he had drunk a bucket full of wine. Ludar spoke.
You come to the monastery tomorrow and demand the money.
The man was now free from pain, but was afraid that the abbot would hear of the matter and punish him. He was angry, but he suppressed his passion. He dare not ask for the money. He divided the remaining wine in the two buckets, shouldered his load, and flew down the mountain. Ludar sat in the arbour for half the day, and the wine mounted to his head. He took off his gown and tied it round his waist by the sleeves, exposing his tattooed back. In this manner he went back up the hill, swinging his arms. As he neared the monastery, the gatekeeper saw him and placed two bamboo boards across the entrance, and called out to him,
You are a disciple of Buddha, and yet you come here drunk. You're not blind. You have seen the order posted at the treasury that monks are forbidden to drink wine, and if they disobey this, they will receive 40 blows with the bamboo and be expelled from the monastery. If we allow you to enter in this state, we shall be punished with 10 blows. Go away at once, and we will not say anything.
Although Ludar was now a monk, yet he had not changed his temper. He stared at them and cursed,
You thieving bastards! If you hit me, I will fight you.
Seeing the danger of trouble, one of the gatekeepers ran to report the matter to the superintendent. Ludar knocked the bamboo boards to one side, slapped the gatekeeper's face, and stumbled forward. The gatekeeper attempted to stop him, but Ludar knocked him down. This was certainly disgraceful, but he stumbled forward into the courtyard. The superintendent had collected together about 30 servants and armed them with white sticks. Upon meeting them, Ludar roared like a clash of thunder and advanced with big strides. The servants, seeing his fierce appearance, hurriedly retreated to the storeroom and closed the two folding doors. Ludar struck the doors and kicked until he forced the doors open. The men were cornered, and Ludar, seizing a stick, drove them out. The superintendent had reported the trouble to the abbot, who, taking his 5 attendants, arrived on the scene and called out, Ludar, you are making a mistake. Although Ludar was drunk, yet he recognized the abbot. He threw away the stick and saluted.
I have had only 2 cups of wine. These men came and hit me.
Pay attention, replied the abbot. Go and sleep at once, and tell me about it tomorrow.
I would kill you bald-headed donkeys but for the abbot, said Ludar.
The abbot ordered his attendants to assist Ludar to a bed in the dormitory, and upon reaching it he fell down and was soon fast asleep and snoring. A crowd of monks now surrounded the abbot, saying,
We remonstrated with you before, and now this has happened. We object to this wildcat remaining here, as he will only upset our pure ways of life.
The abbot replied, Though there is trouble now, there will be a different state of affairs afterwards. I have no alternative, but you will forgive him when you appreciate the influence of his donor. Tomorrow I will tell him that I cannot tolerate such bad conduct, and that will end the matter.
What an injudicious abbot, jeered the monks.
They all separated to their rest. The next day, after breakfast, the abbot sent his attendants to summon Ludar. He was not awake. They waited until he arose and put on his long gown. Suddenly, he dashed out, to the surprise of the attendants. Following, they found Lu Dar pissing behind the temple. When he had finished, he went with them to the abbot.
Lu Dar, said the abbot, you were previously a military man and were introduced here by Zhao Yuanwei, and I have given you some instructions. You must not take life, nor steal, nor fornicate, nor drink wine, nor lie. These are the usual 5 prohibitions for monks. But the most important is that you should not drink wine. Why did you return drunk last night? Strike the gatekeepers, break open the doors of the storeroom, drive out the servants, and generally misbehave yourself. Why did you do this?
Lu Dar knelt and replied,
I dare not do it again.
The abbot asked, Why did you break our rule about drinking wine and so broke our laws of purity? I should have expelled you from the monastery if it had not been for the good character of your benefactor, Zhao Yuanwai. Hereafter, you must not break our rules. Lu Dar arose and, clasping his hands, said,
I certainly will not dare do that.
The abbot then took him aside and ordered breakfast for them both. During the meal, he gave him good advice, a monk's robe of fine cloth and a pair of shoes, before dismissing him. When there is wine drinking, one must not go to excess. There is a common saying, matters can be settled or ruined by wine. Cowards drink wine. They can have false courage and muddle their affairs. But what does it do to the bold and impetuous? After the drunken brawl, Lu Dar dared not venture out of the monastery for 3 months. One day, in the second lunar month, the weather was very hot, and he strolled out of the monk's quarters, standing outside the monastery gate, gazing and appreciating the beautiful view. Suddenly, he heard the sound of knocks down the mountain carried upwards by the wind. He returned for some silver, which he hid in his breast, and then slowly walked down the hill. At the bottom, he saw a crowd of people attending a fair. There were butchers, greengrocers, wine and bread shops. He thought if he had known of this place earlier, he would not have drunk the wine of the bucket, but have gone there for it. These few days he had felt depressed, so he decided to ascertain what eatables were procurable. He heard again the sound of knocking, and he knew that it was iron being worked. He saw on the wall between 2 shops the characters for the Father and Son Inn. One of the 2 was a blacksmith's shop, in which 3 men were working, and Lu Dar asked them if they had good steel. The blacksmiths saw that Lu Dar had a short growth of beard, which gave him a disagreeable appearance, and made them half afraid of him at first sight. They ceased work and said,
Reverend, please be seated. What kind of work have you for us?
Lu Dar said,
I want you to make an iron staff and a broad sword. I did not know you have such good steel here.
A blacksmith answered,
We have good steel here. You better give us the order, for we do not yet know how heavy you want them.
Lu Dar said,
I need a staff weighing 100 jin.
The blacksmith laughed, saying,
Very heavy, master. I'm afraid we cannot do it. But even if we could, perhaps you could not use it. The great halberd used by Guan Gong was only 81 jin.
I am not as good as Guan Gong, but he was only a man, said Lu Dar.
According to my idea, a staff of, say, 62 jin will be heavy enough.
Now, according to your account of Guan Gong's great halberd, make me one of 81 jin, said Lu Dar.
Reverend, it will be very big, it will not look well, and will be inconvenient to use. I think it would be better to make one of 62 jin and have it brightly polished. But if you cannot use it, do not blame me. As you've decided upon it, we will not go into details. We will use the best iron and make it here.
How much do you want for making them? Asked Lu Dar.
Not more than 5 taels of silver, replied the blacksmith.
I will accept your word. So here is the money, said Lu Dar. If it is well made, I will give you extra money.
The blacksmith received the money and said,
It shall be done at once.
Lu Dar walked a short distance from the shop and saw the signboard of a wine shop. He lifted the curtain at the door, entered, and sat down. He tapped on the table, calling for wine.
Excuse me, Reverend,
said the innkeeper. "This wine shop belongs to the monastery which furnished the capital. The abbot controls our affairs and does not like us to sell wine to men from his monastery. But should we do so, he would expel us. So do not consider it impolite if we cannot supply you."
"Never mind that," replied Ludar. "You can sell me some wine and I will not say a word about it."
"I cannot do that," answered the innkeeper. "Please go to another place and don't think us rude."
Ludar rose, saying, "I will go and will not talk further with you." Going out a few paces, he saw a flag over the door of a wine shop. He entered, sat down and called for wine.
Reverend, you evidently do not understand that the abbot controls our affairs, and so by coming here, you endanger our livelihood."
Ludar was determined to have wine, but he knew that they would not sell any. He tried some more shops with the same result. In the distance, he saw a broom hanging in front of a house, which was situated in a cluster of the apricot trees. Upon approaching, he found it was a small inn just outside the village. He went in and sat down near the window, calling,
"Innkeeper, I am a stranger here, and I want a cup of wine."
The proprietor looked at him carefully.
"Reverend, where do you come from?"
"I am a travelling monk, and I happen to pass here."
"Well, if you're from the monastery at Mount Wutai, I cannot sell you any wine."
"I do not come from there. Bring me some wine quickly."
The proprietor saw that Ludar had the manner and speech of another district, so asked how much wine he wanted.
"Bring me a large cup of warm wine," said Ludar. What meat can I have with it?"
This morning I had some beef, but it is now all finished."
Ludar could smell the meat which was being cooked, so going outside he saw along the wall an earthen boiler containing dog's flesh. He said,
"Why don't you sell me this?"
I was afraid that a monk might not eat the dog's flesh."
"I have some silver," said Ludar, offering it to the proprietor. "Let me have half of the dog."
The proprietor prepared the dish with some powdered garlic and placed it before Ludar, who tore the flesh apart with his fingers and, dipping it in the garlic, ate it. Although he drank 10 cups of wine, he still wanted more. The innkeeper was afraid and remarked he had had enough. Ludar stared at him.
"I will pay you, so why interfere?"
The man asked how much he wanted, and Ludar said,
"A bucketful."
This was supplied, and Ludar drank it rapidly. There was still a leg of the dog, which he picked up and put in his breast. As he left the inn, he said that he would come again the next day. The proprietor was speechless on hearing this, and saw that he was going in the direction of Mount Wutai. Ludar walked halfway up the mountain and rested in an arbour till the effect of the wine passed away. At last, getting up, he said to himself, "For a long time I've had no drill in hand combat and I feel my body's not in good form. I will have a little practice here." Taking his long sleeves, he rolled up the ends and thrust in all directions. He was swinging his arm when he struck against a pillar of the arbour with such force as to break it, and it fell with a great crash. The doorkeeper of the monastery heard this noise, and looking below saw that Ludar was staggering up the path. He said,
"Much trouble, this brute is extremely drunk again."
Closed the gate, and taking the bar, fastened it. Then gazed through a crack in the door and watched Ludar approaching. When Ludar reached the door, he struck it with his fist, but the gatekeeper dared not open it. Ludar turned and saw on the left side of the door a guardian idol, covered with gilt, to which he shouted,
"You big prick! Why do you not knock the door for me instead of frightening me with that attitude? But I'm not afraid of you."
He then mounted the steps, took hold of the railings in front of the idol, and pulled them up as if plucking onions. He took one of the broken rails and struck the idol. The painted clay fell to the ground. The gatekeeper, seeing this, ran to report it to the abbot. Ludar then turned and saw another gilded idol, at which he shouted,
"You are opening your mouth wide and laugh at me."
He ascended the steps on that side and struck the foot of the idol twice with the railing. There was a tremendous noise as the idol fell to the ground, at which Ludar laughed loudly. When the abbot heard of the matter, he said, "We must not make him angry. You had better go away."
A crowd of monks had collected, and they said, "That wildcat is extremely drunk. He's broken the arbor and the idols at the entrance. What shall we do?" "Since ancient times, the emperor has always avoided drunken men. So why should I not do the same?" said the abbot. "As to the images and the arbor he destroyed, the patron will repair them." The monks left the abbot's quarters, saying, "How stupid is our abbot? The doorkeepers do not open the door, but listen." Outside, Lu Da was shouting,
"You thieving, stinking, bald-headed donkeys! If you do not let me enter the monastery, I will set fire to the building."
The monks, upon hearing this, told the gatekeepers to draw the bar and let the brute in. They did this quietly and stealthily, and then hurried into the buildings to hide themselves. The monks also got out of the way. Lu Da, using both hands, pushed against the doors with great force and fell to the ground as they opened. Scrambling up, he rubbed his head and then rushed into the meditation hall. There were many visiting monks seated in contemplation, and they were alarmed at his sudden, noisy entrance. Lu Da went to the side of the hall and vomited. The monks were disgusted with the stench and covered their noses with their hands. Lu Da got on a bed, took off his silk belt, and tore apart the fastenings of his clothes, and the dog's leg fell out.
"How nice," he said, picking it up. "I am very hungry just now."
So saying, he ate it. Upon seeing this, the monks covered their faces with their sleeves, and those on both sides of him withdrew. Lu Da, seeing this movement, offered a piece of the dog's leg to a monk who covered his face with his sleeves. Lu Da asked why he did not eat it, and then pushed the flesh at the lips of another monk. About 5 monks on neighbouring beds leapt forward to intervene, but Lu Da, throwing the meat away, hit the monk with his fist several times. This raised a loud shout from the monks, who went to the cupboards to get their clothes and alms bowls with the idea of leaving. This created a general confusion, which the monk in charge could not control. The superintendent summoned all the servants, including groundsmen, cook's assistants, messengers, sedan chair carriers, altogether about 200 men, who seized sticks, rice shovels, staffs and cudgels, and placing towels round their heads, entered the hall in a body. Upon seeing them, Lu Da howled, and having no weapon, hurried to the centre of the hall, pushed over the table for offerings in front of Buddha, and having broken off 2 of the legs, he advanced. When the menial monks saw his fierce expression, they retreated to the veranda. But as Lu Da only flourished the table legs, they soon returned to the attack. Lu Da was very angry and struck on both sides. He had moved towards the hall where the scriptures were expounded, and there he met the abbot, who called out, "Lu Da, you are unreasonable. You monks must not lay a hand on him." The monks retreated, and Lu Da threw away the legs of the table, asking the abbot,
"Will you tell me what I must do?"
At that moment, Lu Da was nearly sober.
"Lu Da, you have implicated me seriously," said the abbot. "You were drunk previously and created a lot of trouble. Now you are again drunk, knocked down an arbor and broken 2 idols. You have also made trouble with the monks, so that they have all to go away. This sin of yours is not a small one. This, my Wenshu monastery on Mount Wutai, has been kept holy and sacred for more than 1,000 years. So how can I keep a filthy thing like you here? But you can live in my quarters for a few days more, until I find a place for you to go."
Lu Da accompanied the abbot to his quarters. The abbot sent word for the visiting monks to return and continue their contemplations. The monks that were injured had their wounds attended to. Next day, the abbot wrote a letter to Zhao Yuanwai, sending it with 2 messengers who waited for his reply. When Zhao Yuanwai read the letter, he was very sad. He wrote a reply and said that he would pay for the repairs. As for Lu Da, he would leave him to the abbot to be banished. When the abbot received the letter, he instructed his attendants to bring a gown of black cloth, a pair of shoes, 10 taels of silver, and fetch Lu Da. Upon his arrival, the abbot reproved him about his offences, telling him he had decided to expel him from the monastery. He continued, During the night I thought of your affairs, and have prepared for you 4 sentences from our sayings, which you can use until your dying day. Laughing monk with staff so rare, and ordained sword so beautiful, fought with heroes everywhere, and punished traitorous ministers. We will now relate what the abbot said. Chapter 4. Little Tyrant, when drunk, goes inside the bed curtains. Lu Da, the monk, has a fight at Taohua village. The abbot spoke.
Ji Shen, you certainly cannot stay here, but I have a brother in religion called Ji Qing Jin Shen, who is the abbot of Great Qiangguo Monastery in Kaifeng, and you can go there for refuge and work for the monks. I have here a letter of introduction for you. Last night I thought over your case and decided to give you 4 sentences from our sacred sayings, and until your dying day, you must not forget them. Lu Da, Ji Shen, knelt down and said,
I am willing to listen to these sayings.
The abbot continued and said,
1. When you see a forest, your lot will be improved. 2. When you see a mountain, you will become rich. 3. When you enter a prefecture, you will move on. And 4. When you see a river, you will stop.
Lu Da, upon hearing these 4 sayings, kowtowed 3 times 3. He then put on his back a bundle, 2 girdles round his waist, hid away the letter, bid farewell to the abbot and the crowd of monks. He departed from Mount Wutai and went to the inn in the village near the blacksmith's shop, where he stayed for a few days until the monk's staff and broadsword were finished. He also got a scabbard for the sword and had the staff varnished. He took a number of pieces of silver and paid the blacksmith. He left, and the passers-by gazed after him, as he was really a very strange sight. He followed the road towards the eastern capital, Kaifeng. In more than 1/2 month, he had not slept in a single monastery, but had rested and eaten his food at inns, and bought his wine in wine shops. One day, he was enjoying the scenery of a mountain stream, and did not notice it was evening, and that he had not found a place to sleep. The road was quite deserted. After he had gone 30 li more, he passed over a plank bridge, where he saw in the distance a red light emerging from a group of trees. It was a farmhouse in a wood, with surrounding wild mountains rising one above the other. He went to the farmhouse and saw outside 12 men who were very busy moving things about. He placed his staff against the wall and spoke to the men to attract their attention. The villagers said,
Monk, why do you arrive so late at our farm?
Lu Da replied,
As I cannot find an inn near here, I should like to stay at your farm tonight, and will leave here early tomorrow morning.
We have some business here tonight, so that you cannot stay.
However inconvenient it is, let me stay tonight.
Monk, you'd better go at once, and do not risk your life here.
This is strange. If I only stay for one night, how shall I risk my life?
Go away, said the villagers. If you do not go, we shall tie you up.
Lu Da became angry.
You villagers are unreasonable. I have not said anything wrong, yet you want to tie me up.
Some of the villagers abused him, while others acted as mediators. Lu Da took his staff and threatened to beat them. Just then, he saw an old man. He was over 60 years of age and was walking with a staff that reached above his head. He called,
What is all this noise about?
The villagers answered,
This detestable monk desires to beat us.
Lu Da spoke.
I am from Mount Wutai, and am on my way to the eastern capital on some business. This evening I have not found an inn, and should like to make use of your noble house for one night. Your servants were unreasonable and wanted to tie me up.
The old man said,
As you are a monk from Mount Wutai, please come inside.
They went into the guest chamber and sat down. The old man said,
You must not think us impolite because our servants did not know that you are from a place where there is a living Buddha, and they took you as an ordinary person. I previously believed in Buddhism. Although we have some affair this evening, yet you may stay here tonight.
Lu Da placed his staff against a chair, and rising, signified his appreciation, and then asked his host's name.
My name is Lu, and the villagers call me Grandpa Lu. This place is called Taohua Village. May I ask your name, and also your religious name?
My superior, the abbot Ji Jen, gave me the name Ji Shen, but my surname is Lu.
Reverend, will you take a little supper with me? But I do not know whether you are willing to eat meat with me.
I can eat meat and drink wine. Whether the wine is yellow or clear, or from Shaoqing, I am not particular. And I can eat either meat or dog's flesh.
Very soon the servants prepared a table with a plate of beef and four different vegetables. Lu Da, Ji Shen, took off his belt and waist girdle and sat down. He did not stand on ceremony, nor did he decline anything. Grandpa Lu, who sat opposite, stared at him, but only ate rice. When the servants cleared the table, Grandpa Lu told them that as things were upset, Lu Da would sleep in a small side room. He then informed Lu Da that if there was a noise outside in the night, he should not notice it. Lu Da inquired what was the affair to occur that night, and he was told that it was something that a monk could not take part in.
But why is your appearance so sorrowful? Asked Lu Da. I hope that my coming has not been inconvenient. I will give you money for my lodging tomorrow.
Grandpa Lu said,
Reverend, please listen to me. I always give food to monks and bestow charity on them, so I cannot accept money from you. Tonight I have invited someone to come and marry my daughter. Therefore, I am quite busy.
Lu Da laughed loudly.
When men and women are fully grown, they must marry. This is the proper thing for men, and it is in accordance with the five constant virtues. So why should there be trouble?
Grandpa Lu said,
You, Reverend, do not understand this marriage, but the fact is that my daughter is not willing to marry.
Lu Da laughingly replied,
Sir, you are a silly fellow. If she does not agree, why have you invited the man to marry her?
Grandpa Lu remarked,
I have only one daughter, and she is 19 years old. Near here, there is a mountain called Mount Taohua. Recently, two bandit chiefs have erected a stronghold there and have collected about 700 men, and they rob the cottages near here. The officers in charge of the troops at Qingzhou have tried to arrest them without success. The bandits then came here and demanded money. When one of the chiefs saw my daughter, he presented her 20 taels of gold and a roll of red embroidered silk as a token of his desire for an engagement. He has selected this night to come and marry the girl. I cannot dispute the matter with him, but I must agree to his demand, and that is why I am annoyed.
Lu Da, upon hearing this, said,
So that is the case. But if I have the means of causing him to change his mind about taking away your daughter, how will that do?
He is king of demons and kills men without moving an eyelash, so how can you get him to change his mind?
I studied under the abbot at Mount Wutai, and therefore I can speak reasonably. Even if he were a man of iron or stone, I could alter his decision. Tell your daughter to hide in some other place this evening, and I will stay in her room.
That will be fine, but do not pull the tiger's whiskers, said Grandpa Lu.
Is that not my business? Asked Lu Da. Leave it to me, and I'll do the correct thing.
Certainly, it will be all right, said Grandpa Lu. We are very lucky in meeting such a living Buddha as you.
He then asked Lu Da if he would like something more to eat, but the latter replied,
Only wine.
Grandpa Lu ordered the servants to bring a big bowl of wine, as well as a cooked goose, both of which were eaten by the monk, who told the servants to place his bundle in the room. Then, putting his sword in his belt and picking up his monk's staff, he asked if the girl was in hiding. Grandpa Lu had sent his daughter to a neighbor's house and led Lu Da to the bride's apartment. The servants withdrew to prepare the banquet. Lu Da placed the tables and chairs that were in the room to one side, put his sword at the head and his staff at the side of the bed, let down the bed curtains covered with gilt letters, took off his clothes, and lay down. Grandpa Lu saw that it was getting dark, so he told the servants to light the lanterns which were outside. He had a table placed on the threshing floor, on which were flowers, incense sticks, and lanterns.
He also instructed them to get a dish of meat ready and heat a large kettle of wine. About 10 o'clock, they heard the sound of gongs and drums being beaten on the hill. Grandpa Lu thought of a vile scheme, and the servants were almost in a state of panic. They all went outside the gate of the farm, but upon seeing in the distance a great illumination from 500 torches, they fled into the farmhouse. Grandpa Lu had the gate opened and proceeded to welcome the guests. He saw two bodies of men, one in front of the other. They were armed with all kinds of military weapons, glittering in the light, and were decorated with red and green silk. The bandits had stuck wild flowers in their caps and carried 4 or 5 red gauze lanterns, which lit the road for their leader, who was riding a horse. On his head he had a flat-topped cap of red colour, and near his temple was a large imitation flower made of silk. He wore a long green gown with tiger design embroidered in gold. Round his waist, a red sash fastened with a golden buckle. Standing away from this a few inches, a stiff girdle was suspended. Leather boots with designs of clouds on them. He was riding a big white horse and dismounted at the gate of the farmhouse. The bandits offered congratulations by singing, "Tonight his cap is very bright, for he is a bridegroom. Clothed with handsome dress is he, and all his cheeks abloom." Grandpa Lu poured out a cupful of wine, and kneeling on the ground, offered it to the bandit leader, who, however, raised him, saying, "You are my father-in-law, so why do you kneel before me?"
"As you are the chief of this district, and my family is under your control, you should not object like this," replied Grandpa Lu.
The bandit chief was almost drunk, and laughingly replied,
"As I am to be your son-in-law, I will treat you fairly. As your daughter is to be my wife, things will soon be all right."
Upon reaching the threshing floor, the bandit chief saw the preparations and asked,
"Father-in-law, why do you receive me in this way?"
He drank 3 cups of wine at that spot. He told his men to tie up his horse to a poplar and went toward the guest room. His men began to play on the musical instruments and beat the drums. Upon entering the guest room, the bandit chief sat down, asking for his wife. Grandpa Lu replied,
"My daughter is so timid that she dare not come here."
The robber chief laughed and, taking a cup of wine, said,
"I should like my wife to come here and drink some wine with me."
Grandpa Lu thought this a suitable opportunity for the monk to act as mediator, so he requested the guest to come with him. He took a candle and, going to the bridal chamber, pointed, saying,
"This is the room. Please enter."
Grandpa Lu took the candle and departed, as he did not expect trouble. The bandit chief pushed the door open and saw that the interior was dark. He said,
"My wife's father is really so economical that he's not even a lamp lighted in the room and let my wife to sit in the dark. Tomorrow I will tell one of my men to bring a bucket of good oil to my mountain stronghold, so that my wife can light the lamp there."
Lu Da, lying inside the bed curtains, heard all this, but he suppressed his inclination to laugh and made no sound. The bandit chief felt his way into the dark room, calling out,
"Wife, why do you not come to receive me? You need not be so timid, because tomorrow you will be the leading woman in my stronghold."
Feeling his way in the darkness and calling,
"Wife, wife!"
he at last touched the embroidered bed curtains and lifted them. Then, reaching with his hand, he felt the belly of Lu Da. The latter at once took hold of the bandit chief's head and pressed him down on the bed. The chief struggled to get up, but Lu Da abused him.
"You are certainly a bastard,"
and lifting his fist, struck a blow.
"Why did you hit your husband?"
he asked. Lu Da shouted,
"I am teaching you how to recognize your old woman."
He pulled him to the floor at the side of the bed, belabored him with his fist, and kicked him, while the bandit called out,
"Save me! Save me!"
Upon hearing this, Grandpa Lu was almost startled out of his wits, and hastily picking up a lamp, led the bandits into the room. There they saw a big fat monk, stark naked, on top of the bandit chief, beating him. The bandits had their spears and cudgels, and Lu Da, upon seeing these, let go the chief and got his monk's staff from the bed. The men, seeing his fierce bearing, all retreated, followed by Lu Da. Seizing the opportunity, the bandit leader crawled to the door of the room and walked into the yard. He soon found his unsaddled horse in the dark, broke off a twig from the tree, and jumped on the horse. He hit the horse with the twig, but it did not move. The robber leader said to himself, "Oh, what a nuisance, even the horse despises me." He then realized that he had omitted to loosen the reins, which were still fastened to the tree. He quickly snatched them, and the horse galloped away with him. As he passed through the gate, he cursed Grandpa Lu, saying, "You old ass need not hurry. Wherever you fly, I shall catch you." He lashed the horse, which carried him up the mountain. Grandpa Lu caught hold of Lu Da, saying, "Reverend, you have brought trouble to my home." Lu Da replied, "You cannot say that I have done something improper. Bring me my clothes, and when dressed, I will talk with you." This was done, and Grandpa Lu said, "I hoped you would be reasonable and get him to change his mind. I did not expect you to assault him. He will now gather a large body of his men and come to kill us." Lu Da replied,
"Grandpa, do not get excited, and I will tell you something. I am a major in the army of Grand Secretary Liang at Yanan Prefecture. I became a monk because I killed a man. You need not speak of these bandits, for I should not be afraid of 2,000s of them on foot or mounted. If you do not believe me, then pick up my monk's staff and look at it."
A servant tried to lift the staff, but he could not move it. Lu Da, however, picked it up in his hand and whirled it round as though it were only a lamp wick made of rush. Lu said,
"Reverend, you must stay here and protect us."
"That is needless talk, because I will not go away."
The farmer told his servants to bring more wine, but to be careful not to make the guest drunk. Lu Da said,
"If I drink only a little wine, I can do only a small piece of business. But if I drink a lot, then I can do more."
On Mount Taohua, the principal head of the bandits was thinking of sending one of his men to inquire about his second-in-command's marriage. When the armed bandits returned with a defeated appearance, he asked why they were in such disorder, and they told him that their second-in-command had been defeated. At this, he was surprised, but while he was listening to details, his assistant arrived. He noticed that he was not wearing the usual red cloth round his head, and that his green dress was in tatters. As he dismounted in front of the main building, he called,
"Elder brother, please save me."
And when he was asked for an explanation, he continued,
"I went down the mountain to the village where Grandpa Lu lives and found that the detestable old donkey had hidden the woman and had got a big monk to be on the bed in her place. I was quite unprepared for attack, and when I groped my way to the bed and touched him, he hit me with his fist, kicked me, and severely maltreated me. When my men entered the room, he chased them out, and while this was happening, I managed to get away. Elder brother, I want revenge."
The principal bandit leader answered,
"So, this is it. You rest indoors while I go and seize this bald-headed thief."
He then commanded his men to get his horse ready. He mounted and led his men down the mountain, who shouted as they went along. Lu Da was drinking wine when a servant reported that the bandits were again approaching.
"Keep cool," said Lu Da. "I will knock them down, and you can tie them up and take them to the Yamen. Let somebody bring my sword."
He then took off his long gown, tucked his short underclothing in his belt, put on his broadsword. He picked up the iron monk's staff and strode to the gate, where he saw the bandit leader seated on a horse and holding a spear, surrounded by many torches. He heard him shout,
"Where is that bald-headed donkey? Tell him to come at once, as we must fight out the matter."
Lu Da was angry and abused him.
"You dirty rascal, you shall certainly recognize me."
He then lifted his iron monk's staff and whirled it round. The leader of the bandits called,
"The sound of your voice is familiar to me. What is your name?"
Lu Da answered,
"I am none other than Major Lu Da, in the employment of Grand Secretary Liang. Just now, however, I am a monk called Lu Jishen."
The leader of the bandits laughed and dismounted and threw away his spear, knelt down and making salutations said,
"Is my elder brother quite well? I'm aware that my younger brother felt the weight of your hand."
As Lu Da suspected that was a trick, he retreated several steps and examined the man closely by the light of the torches. He then recognized him as a drill instructor who had often sold medicine on the streets and was named Li Zheng, with the nickname the Tiger Fighting General. In those days, the thieves did not consider it advisable to say kneel down in their band, so they used another expression, scissors and brush, as a kind of code. Li Zheng now arose and said,
"Elder brother, why are you a monk?"
Lu Da replied, "I will talk that over with you indoors." When Grandpa Lu heard this, he was afraid of more trouble, as he thought that they both were thieves. When Lu Da was inside, put on his clothes, sat at a table, and called for Grandpa Lu, the latter did not care to come. So Lu Da said,
"Grandpa, you need not fear. He is my younger brother."
When Grandpa Lu heard this, he was more confused. Still, he came forward and sat on Lu Da's left. Lu Da gave a resume of how he had killed the bully and afterwards entered a monastery where he became drunk on two occasions, had been expelled, and sent to Kaifeng. Li Zheng explained that when he heard Lu Da had killed the butcher at Weizhou, he tried to find him. Hearing the police wish to arrest him, he also went away. He happened to pass near this mountain and was attacked by the bandits in charge of Zhao Tung, nicknamed Little Tyrant, but he repulsed them, so they invited him to join them as their leader. Lu Da said,
"As things are like this, you need not say anything about the bridal fiasco, because if Zhao Tung had taken the girl, her father would have become a vagrant."
Grandpa Lu was much pleased at this, and ordered the servants to bring wine and food, and entertained his two guests well. He also ordered that each of the bandits was to have two small loaves of bread, two slices of meat, and a big cup of wine. Lu Da told Li Zheng to take the gold and silk, prepared by Grandpa Lu, and give them back to Little Tyrant. Li Zheng asked both of them to come to the stronghold on the mountain and stay for a few days. This was agreed to. Sedan chairs were prepared for Lu Da and Lu, while Li Zheng rode his horse. It was daybreak, and upon arrival at the stronghold, they entered the hall to discuss matters. Zhao Tung was sent for, but when he saw the monk, he was angry and said,
"So my older brother has not carried out my revenge, but asked the monk to come and invited him to sit in the premier place."
Li Zheng laughed.
"This monk is the one who killed the bully with three blows of his fist, about which I have told you many times."
Zhao Tung rubbed his head and exclaimed,
"Aiya!"
He then knelt and saluted Lu Da, who returned the compliment, saying,
"Pray excuse my intrusion."
They all sat down, and Lu Da explained the position to Zhao Tung, advising him to break his engagement and find a better girl. The wedding presents were handed to him. Zhao Tung agreed to this and promised to let the matter drop, saying,
"This is a vow taken with the breaking of an arrow."
Grandpa Lu was satisfied and returned home while the bandits prepared a feast for Lu Da. During the following days, they took their guest all over the mountain to see the splendid wild scenery. The mountain was covered with grass and trees and was difficult of access, there being only one road. After a few days, however, Lu Da saw that Li Zheng and Zhao Tung were mean and had no nobility in their natures. When he told them he wanted to leave, they pressed him to remain, but he reminded them he, being a monk, could not join them. The bandit chief said,
"As you have definitely decided to go, please wait until tomorrow when we will go down the mountain and plunder somebody for money, which we will give you for your travelling expenses."
The next day they made a big banquet, at which the wine cups were of gold and silver. But just as they sat down, one of their men came to report that below were two carts with about 10 travellers. Upon hearing this, the bandit chiefs summoned their followers and said to Lu Da,
"Elder brother, you will have to drink our wine by yourself, but we will leave two men to wait upon you. We must go and get the money for you."
So saying, they left with their men. Lu Da thought,
"These two men are certainly very mean, as they have plenty of gold and silver here to give me, but instead they want to plunder other people for money and give it to me. Is not this being generous at other people's expense? So I will frighten these two men who are attending on me."
He then told the men to bring him some warm wine, and after drinking some, he got up and knocked them down with his fists. He then took their girdles and tied their arms and legs. He gagged them with balls of hempen thread. He opened his bundles and threw away everything that was not needed. And then taking the gold and silver cups, he made them flat by stamping on them and packed them in his bundles. He hid the letter from Abbot Chen in his breast pocket, put on his sword, picked up his monk staff, and left the stronghold. He had a good look around and saw that the mountain behind the stronghold was very wild. If, however, he went down the mountain by the ordinary road, he was sure to meet the brigands. So he decided to descend the mountain by rolling down through the grass. He tied his broadsword and the monk's staff to the bundle and threw them down the steep slope. He then rolled himself down to the foot of the mountain without sustaining any injury. He soon found his bundle and started on his way. The bandit chiefs attacked the travellers, who resisted for a long time, but seeing that they were outnumbered, they at last retreated, abandoning their baggage. Upon returning to their stronghold with the loot, the chiefs discovered that Lu Da had gone and had taken away the gold and silver cups, and at first they thought of pursuing him, but after a little discussion, they agreed to let the matter drop. That day, Lu Da walked a distance of about 20 li without coming across an inn, so that by evening he was very hungry. Just then he happened to hear the tinkling of a bell, which he knew was the sound of a bell hanging at the eaves of a Buddhist temple, and it was moved by the wind. So he decided to investigate this. We will now relate what this temple was. A score of souls were lost in half a day. Temples of long standing in ambers were now laid.
Chapter 5. Shi Jin acts as a highwayman in a pine forest. Lu Da sets fire to the Waguan Monastery. Lu had crossed several mountain ridges before he entered a pine forest, and still following a path for about half of 1 li, he at last came to a ruined monastery on the eaves of which bells were tinkling in the breeze. Above the main entrance was an honorary tablet in a horizontal position, with 4 characters, Waguan Monastery, in a dilapidated condition. He crossed a stone bridge, and entering the monastery went to the monks' living rooms. There he found there were no doors, windows, or walls left standing, and wondered how the place had been destroyed. Near the abbot's living quarters, the ground was covered with birds' excreta, and there a door was locked and covered with spiders' webs. He stuck his staff into the ground and called out, "Are there any monks here? I want some food." Although he said this several times, there was no reply. So he went to the kitchen, but found that there was no boiler and that the cooking range had been destroyed. There he placed his bundle in the seat usually occupied by the supervisor at meal times, and then went to look round the place. Behind the kitchen he found a small room in which several emaciated old monks were sitting on the ground. He shouted, "You monks have no manners. I called out several times without getting a single reply from you." They waved their hands and said, "Do not talk so loudly. I am a travelling monk and only demand a meal from you, so what harm is there in that?" An old monk replied, "For 3 days we have had no food, so how can we give you some?" "I am from Mount Wutai, and even if you have only stale congee, I beg you to let me have half a bowl of it." The old monk replied, "As you come from a place where there is a living Buddha, we certainly ought to give you some food, but as a matter of fact, we have not even got a grain of rice in this monastery, and most of the monks have already left. For 3 days, we have not had a bite of food."
"Nonsense! I don't believe that," said Lu Da.
The old monk continued, "This monastery was certainly not a small one, and we collected subscriptions over a large area. But some time ago, a travelling monk came here with a Taoist, and they seized all the property for themselves. They did everything that is bad, and that was why almost all the monks left. We are so old that we could not go with them, and we live here in a state of starvation."
"Nonsense! If these two men did such things, why did you not complain to the government?"
"Reverend, you do not understand. The Yaman is a long way off. But even if the magistrate came here, he would not put matters right, because these two men are exceedingly fierce and would kill somebody or set the place on fire. They live in the abbot's quarters at the back of this building.
What are the names of those two men?
The monk is called Kui. His religious name is Dao Chung, and his nickname is Iron Buddha. The Taoist priest is called Qi Shai, and his nickname is Flying Ogre. But they are just robbers and not like clerics. Outwardly, they look like clerics, but their innermost thoughts are vile.
While Lu Da was listening to this, he became aware of a fragrant smell, and turning around, he saw a cooking pot with a cover of matting through which steam was issuing. He lifted the cover and saw that the pot was full of maize and water. He said,
"You old monk said that you had no food for 3 days, and yet here is a pot full of maize congee. Why did you lie to me?"
When they saw that he had found the congee, they removed the bowls, saucers, chopsticks, and ladles so that he should not eat any. But he was so hungry that he decided to take drastic steps. Taking a broken table near the stove, he wiped off the dust with a wisp of grass. Then, taking the pot with both hands, he emptied the contents on the table. Upon seeing this, all the monks came forward with bowls to help themselves, but Lu Da pushed them away. He took the congee with both hands and ate it. The old monk said, "For 3 days we have had no food, and we obtained this maize outside by begging, but now you eat it." Lu Da had taken about 7 mouthfuls, and so he desisted taking any more. Just then he heard someone outside singing a ribald song, so he washed his hands, picked up his monk's staff, and hurried off to see who was singing. Looking through a partitioned wall, which had been partly broken down, he saw a Taoist who was wearing a black turban, a shirt, a sash of many colours round his waist, hempen shoes, and was carrying a load suspended from a pole over his shoulder. In one bamboo basket was a fish, with its tail showing over the side, and above it was a lotus leaf with some meat on the top. In the other basket, he carried a bottle of wine, also covered by a lotus leaf. He was singing,
"You there, I here, each leads a single life. You have no husband, I have no wife. I have no wife, how lonely I must be. You have no husband, don't you pity me."
All the old monks had followed Lu Da, and they now pointed to the Taoist and whispered,
"That is the priest called Flying Ogre."
Lu Da took his staff, following the Taoist, who entered the abbot's living quarters, without knowing he was being followed. Inside, Lu Da saw an ash tree in the courtyard with a table under it, on which were plates of vegetables, 3 wine cups, and 3 pairs of chopsticks. At the table sat a fat monk, whose eyebrows looked as though they had been brushed and waxed stiff. He was very muscular, and his face sallow. His clothing was not fastened, and disclosed his belly. At his side sat a young woman. The Taoist put down the baskets and took a seat. Lu Da walked to the table, and the monk, being startled at seeing him, rose and said,
"I request you, my brother, to sit down and have a cup of wine with us."
"Why have you two destroyed this monastery?" asked Lu Da.
"Oh, brother, please be seated and listen to me."
Lu Da stared at him and said,
"Say on, say on."
The priest continued,
"Previously this monastery had much land and many monks. Those old monks who are now in the veranda used to drink wine and use the monastery money for women. The abbot issued an order prohibiting these practices, and as the monks disobeyed the order, he resigned. They ruined the monastery then and sold the land so that many of the monks left. The Taoist and I have recently arrived, and we intend to repair the monastery."
"Who is this woman, and why is she drinking wine here?"
"Oh, brother, allow me to tell you that she is the daughter of Wang Yujin, who lives in a village nearby. Her father was a donor of our monastery, but now he is ruined, and the family is in extreme poverty. Her husband was inflicted with a disease, and as there was no other person at home, she came here to borrow rice. I knew her, and therefore gave her a drink of wine. There was no other intention. You, brother, must not listen to all those old animals have to say."
Lu Da believed what he heard, so replied,
"How that old monk has deceived me."
So saying, he picked up his staff and returned to the kitchen. The old monks had eaten all the maize congee, but were still there. He pointed at them and said,
"It was you who previously destroyed this monastery, and you have told me a lot of lies."
An old monk replied,
Brother, you must not listen to their talk, as they keep a woman inside there. They saw you had your sword and the heavy monk's staff, and as they were not armed, did not care to fight with you. If you do not believe me, then go back and see how they treat you the second time. Brother, think a little. They have both wine and meat, whereas we cannot even get congee, and we were afraid that you would eat the little we had.
What you say seems reasonable, said Ludar.
He took his staff and returned to the abbot's quarters, but found the door closed. He was angry and kicked open the door. He hurried inside and saw that Iron Buddha was now armed with a halberd and was advancing towards the ash tree with the intention of fighting Ludar, who gave a loud whoop and, whirling aloft his monk's staff, engaged Iron Buddha in conflict. They fought 15 bouts, but the Iron Buddha could not overcome Ludar. And then the former took up a defensive attitude, parrying the blows and thrusts, slowly retreating. The Taoist saw that Iron Buddha was getting the worst of the fight, picked up a halberd and came behind Ludar with the intention of stabbing him. Ludar heard footsteps, but dared not turn round. He also saw the shadow of a man and suspected treachery. He called out, "Zhao, I will hit you," and upon hearing this, Night Witch jumped out of the way of Ludar's staff. Ludar turned partly round so that he was facing them both in the form of a triangle. The two men combined to fight with Ludar for 10 bouts. He was hungry and was also tired through walking so far, and knew that he could not defeat these two men with their spare energy. So he retreated, trailing his staff on the ground. The two men pursued him as far as the monastery gate, where they again fought. Ludar withdrew to a stone bridge, where the two men gave up the pursuit and sat down on the parapet. Ludar went some distance, and then remembered he had left his bundle in the monastery. Moreover, he had no money, and wondered what he must do. He could not go back, as he knew if he faced the two men it would mean disaster. He walked a little further, but was in doubt whether to go on or not. After going a few li, he saw a forest of pine trees which had a forbidding aspect. In the shadow of the trees, he saw a man looking round stealthily, and upon seeing Ludar, he uttered an exclamation, spat, and slipped back into the forest. Ludar thought the man was a robber, who perhaps thought it would be useless to hold up a monk. But Ludar decided to vent his rage on that man and take away the man's clothes, which he could perhaps pawn for wine and food. He called,
"You, footpad, come out at once."
The man in the forest laughed when he heard this and replied,
"I have bad luck, and you come here to pick a quarrel with me."
He then took his halberd and, coming into the open, called out,
"You bald-headed donkey, you are evidently seeking for an opportunity to die."
"You will soon know me,"
called Ludar, who advanced, nourishing his staff, while the other man also came forward, holding his halberd. When they were near each other, the man said,
"Your voice is familiar to me. What is your name?"
Ludar said,
"When I have given you a good beating, I will tell you my name, but not now."
The man was angry, and advancing, fought Ludar. But after a little contact, he began to appreciate the skill of his opponent, whom he had regarded at first as only a stupid monk. So after a few more bouts of fighting, he said,
"Let us rest. I have something to say to you."
They both sprang apart at the same time, and the man said, "What is your name? Your voice seems familiar." Ludar told his name, and upon hearing it, the man threw down his sword, and kneeling, saluted with folded hands, asking,
"Do you not recognize Shi Jin?"
Ludar laughed and replied,
"Can you really be Master Shi?"
He then knelt down and saluted. This done, they both went into the forest and sat down, telling their experiences since they last met. Shi Jin had some cold meat and cakes, which he offered to Ludar, who was hungry. He said,
"As your bundle is in the monastery, I will go there with you and take it. If they decline to give it to us, we will kill them."
Ludar agreed to this, and when they had finished their food, set off for the monastery. On their arrival, they found the flying ogre and Iron Buddha sitting on the parapet of the bridge. Ludar called,
"Come here, you two men. This time I shall kill you."
Iron Buddha laughed.
"I have just defeated you. Why do you come here again?"
Ludar whirled his monk's staff in the air and Iron Buddha seized his halberd and went to meet him. Lu Da felt braver because Shi Jin was now with him, and moreover, was no longer hungry. He fought for 9 bouts, until Iron Buddha became weak and thought of retreating. Seeing this, Flying Ogre went to his assistance, but Shi Jin ran from the shade of a tree and attacked him. There were now 4 men fighting, 2 on each side. After a short time, Lu Da became aware that he was getting the better of his opponents, and shouted, "Strike!" and made a final effort, striking Iron Buddha with his staff, knocking him off the bridge into the water below. When Flying Ogre saw this, he retreated, but Shi Jin, running after him, struck him a blow in the back. Flying Ogre fell down, and Shi Jin, placing his foot on the body, stabbed him repeatedly. Lu Da went under the bridge and killed Iron Buddha. We cannot but pity these 2 ruffians who were sent to their last sleep in this way, and whose deeds passed like a bad dream. Lu Da and Shi Jin went into the monastery and got Lu Da's bundle. They found the old monks had all strangled themselves in order to avoid what they thought would be certain death. When the woman saw Lu Da and Shi Jin, she too was afraid and committed suicide by jumping down the well. They went through the now vacant rooms and found some bundles of clothing lying on a bed, which they opened and found silver inside. In the kitchen they found fish, meat, and wine, which gave them a good meal. Before their departure, they set fire to the monastery. It happened a strong wind was blowing, so that very soon the whole place was in flames. They walked all night, and at dawn saw a large market town in the distance. Just before reaching it, they stopped at an inn, ordering the waiter to buy meat and rice and have it cooked for them. Over their wine, they discussed their future plans, and Shi Jin said he was going to Mount Shaohua to join the bandits there. They left the inn, and after travelling about 7 li, they came to a place where 3 roads met, and Lu Da decided they must separate, as he was going on to the eastern capital. Lu Da arrived at the eastern capital in 9 days. The streets were very crowded and noisy. Upon reaching the centre of the town, he politely asked a passerby where the great Xiangguo Monastery was, and was directed. Upon entering the monastery, he went towards the small room where guests are received. A servant reported his arrival, and without delay the monk came out to welcome the guest. But when he saw the fierce appearance of Lu Da, with his monk's staff and broadsword, he was almost afraid of him. He asked where he had come from, and Lu Da replied that he had come from Mount Wutai and had a letter for the abbot. He took the letter from his bundle and followed the monk, when the latter reminded him that as he was going to see the abbot, he should not carry a sword, but should carry a mat and some sticks of incense, and should kowtow when he met the abbot. So Lu Da put aside his sword, and after some time got the other things in proper order. The monk also told him how to wear his monk gown and how to spread the mat. Just then, the abbot appeared on the scene, and the monk introduced Lu Da to him. Abbot Qing said, "I have not heard from Mount Wutai for a long time." The monk reminded Lu Da that he should salute the abbot at once. But the latter did not know where to put down the incense sticks he was holding, and this made the monk laugh. He took the incense from Lu Da and placed it in an incense urn. Lu Da then saluted 3 times. But the monk told him that he should first have presented the letter. The letter was opened by the abbot, who read how Lu Da had been expelled from Mount Wutai and why he was recommended for employment, and that it was hoped that eventually he would become a reformed character. After reading the letter, the abbot stated that Lu Da could rest in the monk's quarters. The abbot Qing summoned to his living quarters all the staff of the monastery and addressed them. "I want you to all know that Abbot Ji Jen of Mount Wutai is not a good judge of what is good or bad. He has sent us a monk who was previously a military officer and entered our calling because he had killed a man. He made disgraceful rows in the monastery, so they have sent him here. But if he stays here, he may break our rules. So what shall we do?" The monastery manager spoke.
I have a proposal to make. Just outside of the Swanzhou Gate, there is our branch temple with a vegetable garden attached. Near the temple is a barracks for soldiers, and every day the soldiers come with hooligans to steal our vegetables. They also bring horses and sheep to feed there. The monk who resides there cannot stop these depredations. So how would it be if we sent this man to live there? He would, perhaps, control the position. The abbot accepted the suggestion and sent an attendant to bring Lu Da to see him. Upon the latter's arrival, the abbot addressed him. As you have been recommended by Abbot Jen, I will enter your name on our register. Just outside the Swanzhou Gate, we have a branch temple with a vegetable garden, and I want you to take charge of that. Every day you must see that the gardeners send 10 loads of vegetables to this monastery, and you can have whatever is left over. Lu Da said,
Abbot Jen told me that I could do some business here, but instead of being a manager or superintendent, you tell me to manage a vegetable garden.
Brother, you do not understand, said the monk who leads in worship. You will be entered on our roll, but as you have had no experience, how can you manage a monastery? The management of this vegetable garden, however, is quite an important job.
I will not do such work, and must have a position as manager.
You just listen to what I have to say, said the guest's host. There must be a chief of staff who manages our affairs. For instance, I attend to the guests who come here, but more important work is done by the Wei Na, who attends to the monk's discipline, the Shi Jie, abbot's assistant, the Shu Ji, scribe, and the Shu Zhou, who conducts the prayers. And all their work is difficult. Then there are the business manager and his assistant who look after the monastery property. As you have just arrived here, how could you occupy a leading position? Then there is the monk who looks after the storeroom, where the holy scriptures are kept. He is called the storekeeper. The monk who keeps the monastery clean is called the hallkeeper. The monk who looks after the upper chamber is called the chamberlain. There are also the subscriptions collector and the bathhouse keeper. These all manage affairs of the second class. Then there are the pagoda keeper, chief cook, chief tea maker, chief of the lavatories, and chief of the vegetable garden, all managing affairs of the lower class. If you attend to a vegetable garden well for, say, 1 year, you will be promoted to look after the pagoda, and if you do that work well, you will become the bathhouse keeper, and eventually become the superintendent of the temple. Lu Da said,
As there is a prospect of promotion, I will go there tomorrow.
This being decided, Abbot Qing invited him to rest in his private room for the night. The next day, the abbot signed a notice to this effect and sent a man to post it at the branch temple. Lu Da then took leave of the abbot and proceeded to his new duties with 2 monks who acted as guides. We have already mentioned that close to the garden there lived some worthless vagabonds who passed their time gambling and stole vegetables. When they entered the garden that day, they read the notice about the new arrangement, and they agreed among themselves that they must take an early opportunity to pick a quarrel with Lu Da, as he would submit to them when he had been beaten. One man had a plan.
We must entice him to the cesspit to receive our congratulations, and while we're knelt down, we must seize his legs and throw him into the manure pit. That will be a nice bit of fun.
The others thought it was a splendid idea, and they awaited Lu Da's arrival to put it into execution. When Lu Da arrived, the gardeners all came and saluted him, and the keys were handed over to him. The 2 monks who had accompanied him, and also the monk whom he had relieved, bid him goodbye and returned to the principal monastery. Lu Da then went into the garden to look round, and there he saw about 30 of the vagabonds who had a basket filled with fruit and wine. When they saw him, they smiled and said,
We heard that you've come to live here, and therefore we've come to offer you our congratulations, as we are your neighbours.
Lu Da had no suspicion of a trick, and therefore walked up to them near the manure pit. A priestly foot was raised on high. Fierce tigers slunk away. He raised his fist up to the sky. Scaly dragons were dismayed.
you will now learn how these rascals tried to molest Lu Da. Chapter 6. Lu Da uproots a willow tree. Leopard's Head makes a mistake in entering the White Tiger Hall. Now these vagabonds had two leaders, Zheng the Third, nicknamed the Crossing Road Rat, and the other, Li the Fourth, nicknamed Green Grass Snake. And they tried to induce Lu Da towards the cesspit, but he noticed that the crowd of men did not move at all. Lu Da invited them all to come into the temple, but as the two leaders had already knelt down, they did not want to get up, and waited for him to come forward to assist them to get up when they would seize his legs. As they neither moved nor got up, Lu Da at once suspected some trickery, and thought they were surely waiting to pull the tiger's whiskers. So he decided to go forward and make them feel the weight of his fist and foot. As he strode up to them, the leaders said, "We offer you our congratulations." So saying, they advanced on their knees and tried to grab hold of Lu Da's legs. But the latter was too quick for them, and he kicked Green Grass Snake into the cesspit, and then did the same to Old Rat. This made the crowd of rascals speechless, and they all wanted to sneak off. Lu Da shouted that if any man attempted to go away, he would be treated in the same way. No one dared move. In the cesspit, the leaders were peeping out to see what was happening. The cesspit was so deep that they could not touch the bottom. It was a terrible stench, and their heads were covered with maggots. They called out,
"Reverend, please forgive us."
"You rascals there," shouted Lu Da, "come and help these men to get out. I forgive the whole lot of you."
The two leaders were assisted out of the pit, and then they went and stood near a gourd stand, some distance away, as the stench was so strong. Lu Da laughed.
"You foolish fellows! You'd better go to the pool, and after a wash there, I will talk with you."
The leaders did this, and their followers handed them a change of clothing to put on. Lu Da ordered them all to come into the temple, and there, sitting in the centre of the hall, he pointed at the assembled men and said,
"You gang of vagabonds need not try to deceive me. Now, why did you come here to trifle with me?"
They all knelt down, and the leaders replied,
"We live by gambling, and therefore have to depend on your garden for our food. The temple bribed us several times to leave the vegetables alone, but there's no result. Reverend, where do you come from? You are so strong that we must submit to you. We are willing to do whatever you wish."
"I was a major in the army," replied Lu Da, "and because I killed many men, I became a monk. My name is Lu Da. You 30 men are of no account to me, for even if 1,000 soldiers came here, I would defeat them."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.